Yeah. Well, well, well. Hi, everybody. I hope you're well. I hope you're happy, and I hope you might stay with us and enjoy the show. Away we go. Now, that was a bit hairy because I was sitting here. We started dead on 9 o'clock because I thought we might have some curious people who would tune in and see what it was like. Anyway, we started dead on 9 o'clock and we realized that the Windows people or some computer thing aspect had decided to reset itself overnight, and we looked and we just weren't on the air. I have heard of some radio stations that, they sit down there and they do a whole radio show and they're quite oblivious to the fact that nobody is listening. Now, the people listening, that is a very key component of making this whole thing work. But I must say, look, if you think back 100 years to this very day in 1923 on the dining room table, I'm at my dining room table, same thing, different technology. But you think back 100 years to the Hume family, Jack and Stella Hume, on Greenhill Road. He made pipes for a living. You'd be familiar, I think, with that. He made a fortune out of making these concrete, pre-stressed concrete pipes. Anyway, his fancy was radio, and his lovely wife, in fact, was the first person on commercial radio in Australia with the test broadcast that occurred on this day back in 1923. Anyway, we went to air dead on 9 o'clock, very professional, and there we were waving around doing our thing, not connecting. Anyway, we'll check that one next time just to make sure that overnight the Windows people or the computer people haven't readjusted something. You see, it is all so clever. I was saying earlier that we've got maybe half the number of dials and slides and buttons and gauges and whatnot, probably half what I'm used to, but they're more complicated in that they do so much more. Quite incredible. But the technology that was around 100 years ago in its time was amazing and difficult and probably unpredictable and temperamental, just as the sort of thing we're doing today. Groundbreaking, I think. There are, of course, very, very successful online radio stations in the United States with some very big stars, big talent. And I don't know the origins of them, how they sort of came about. But clearly one has to move with the technology that is available. And as I stare at this little box, I am quite amazed at what it can do when, of course, it has a mind to do it. The future of radio, ladies and gentlemen, live streaming. All you do is to not go to a 5.n or a 5dn or whatever your radio station might be. You go to jeremycordeaux.com, and 24 hours a day, unless they fiddle with it while we're not looking, we have live streamed all sorts of stuff. And you can imagine as I sit here on this interesting, eventful, kind of historic, sentimental, romantic morning, thinking about my sort of 60 years in radio and all the people who have come before me and who will come after me. We've got plans, you see, but baby steps to begin with. This program, 9 to 12, is the beginning. Well, the beginning actually was when we started to live stream the podcast, which I do from the garage, the Court of Public Opinion. But we have plans. There's no reason in the world why we can't have a full day. This is just 1 3-hour program. There's absolutely no reason why we can't have a full day. Probably 3-hour shifts, because I think they're probably more comfortable. No, 9 to 12, pardon me, 9 to 12, 12 till 3 and 3 till 6 and so forth. And even midnight to dawn, why not? It's a very convenient way to listen to radio. And I don't know that people have radios. The majority of people seem to have these Google Nest things or the device. And you just simply say, hey, Google, I've got to be careful if I don't start some avalanche of technology. Yes. Well, they just sort of tell the Google Nest what station you want. And I think it would probably... Would it work for this as well? Could you...
I was going to talk to Andy about that.
It's a different technology, though, isn't it?
Well, no, it's sort of all linked in. I want to talk to Andy about that.
Yeah, that could be good if we could link it all in. That could be fantastic. Okay. I had Ann Peters lined up to come in at 10 o'clock, and she messaged me to say that she wasn't well, woke up with a very bad throat, and she didn't really think that she could make it, but she would try. So, Anne, thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you to Anna at the Advertiser, who gave us some nice publicity in this morning's paper. No, that was very kind of you, very, very nice of you. Thank you. Thank you. And somebody else, John Blake and Cheryl, sent me a little note to say they would be tuned in. Hi, John. Now, listen, I know the mischief that flows in your veins and runs through your creative head, but I'll sit here and try not to give you anything to work with. Now, that is either good or bad. I don't know. Anyway, jeremycordeaux.com and the telephone, which I think we've got mastered. It's not a switchboard, which I've said to you before. It's just a mobile phone, a smartphone, which means I can take calls one at a time, but I can't sort of bank them up and stack them as you would in a conventional or, dare I say it, old-fashioned radio station. yes, plenty to talk about. Something that might start you going, and I don't want to sort of dwell on this voice thing too much, but I really do think it's a kind of a seminal and very important moment in the history of this country with ramifications that we can't even imagine. I did tell you, well, it depends on whether you have been watching the podcast or listening to the podcast and watching the postings on Facebook of the Court of Public Opinion. We do that from the garage, and Andy Martin, brilliant Andy Martin and his team, he takes that streaming, that posting on Facebook, and he puts it on his massive network of podcasts. Friday. So Thursday I talked to you about, in the garage anyway, I talked to you about... Sue, my friend, who had been so outraged by what she heard about this cover-up of the Uluru Statement from the Heart that she went to all the trouble of sending me a hard copy. And there you go. I got it here, right here, all 26 inflammatory pages. And I do want to read some of it to you a little bit later on. But this is an extraordinary government. And the extraordinary efforts to bury the other 25 pages of the Uluru Statement from the Heart. You know, one page. It's a one-pager. It not only leaves me, but it leaves anyone with a feeling of, curiosity, outrage. Quite rightly, we got to thank, Peter Credlin for bringing it to everybody's attention. People are nonplussed, horrified. I mean, how could this government or any government possibly believe that they could get away with that? Nothing to see here. Look the other way. Nothing to say. Nothing to see. This open, good, loving, kind, one-page document is sweetness and light, when in actual fact it is the absolute essence of prejudice and hatred and racism. And I listened to Parliament on Wednesday afternoon, question time, and the ducking and weaving of the Labor Party. Senator Wong was left to carry the can. But the ducking and weaving, good God, they could not answer. They would not answer the question on the government and the Prime Minister's dishonesty and regard, this is with regard to the voice, or the Uluru Statement from the Heart. first thing I would say is, where is the media? I mean, the mainstream media. Yeah, they do deal with it, touch upon it, but they are nowhere near as interested in it as they should be. Absent without leave, fellas, maybe? I don't know. Full retreat, under fire, maybe. Don't know. A government that is devoted to 3% of the population, neglecting the issues, and God, there are so many that affect 97% of the rest of the population. They have been elected to represent, I would say, the majority, wouldn't you? And the sooner, I don't know what we do with them. I don't know. The problem I have, I guess, is that the Prime Minister is not stupid. He's a smart man. And it is that he thinks, maybe, that we are stupid, that we wouldn't find out about these other 25 pages of the Uluru message from the heart. And he laughs. He openly laughs. They had a great big chuckle in Parliament the other day. Peter Credlin, search, freedom of information. It wasn't hidden. It was right there for everybody to see. No, it wasn't. No, it wasn't. You can say, it was hidden in plain sight, and we thought very few people would go to the expense and trouble of getting the Freedom of Information Act to work on this. Huh? Anyway, there you go. If you want to talk about that, telephone number is 0491 65 68 60. I can only judge on the people who get in touch with me with or message me on that Facebook page. And I have not had anybody message me. All right, it's true that you probably wouldn't listen to somebody with whom you did not agree, but I would have imagined that I would have had some people tearing my ears off because of the things that I have been saying on that posting and on the podcast. But no. I don't know. Terrible, terrible fires in Hawaii, the beautiful tourist island of Maui. 36 people dead. Now, I don't know what happened. They were saying 6 people had been killed, and then suddenly 36 people had been killed. Anyway, it's a state of disaster. The Americans, the US, the president got involved last night, pledging to do whatever he possibly could to relieve the situation. But what can you do? Nature is an extraordinary, unrelenting, cruel force. And you can't really do very much about it, as well we know here in South Australia. And, there wouldn't be a single state, perhaps maybe Queensland, but most states of Australia are very familiar with what the people of Hawaii are going through at the moment. Absolutely terrible. The cost, well, I don't know. How would you begin to calculate the cost? I can't remember Black Saturday in Victoria. I think 130 people were killed in that fire. I well remember Ash Wednesday here in South Australia and the eerie kind of brown look that everything had. And the quietness and the swinging of the electric light wires. Actually, one of the stories I heard about Hawaii was that the problem was exacerbated and carried on further because of the overhead wiring. Now, that's not unfamiliar, and it wouldn't be unfamiliar to bushfire fighters either. Very good argument, pardon me, to get rid of those overhead wires and underground. If you want a national project, a nation-building project, I couldn't think of anything better to do than getting rid of stoby poles and overhead wiring for various reasons. I mean, the stoby poles are a traffic hazard anyway, but the overhead wiring is a real problem when we get hot weather, and we will get hot weather. And, well, yes, maybe the climate is changing slowly. That's what it does. Tony, I don't know if I... Mark, I don't know if these are numbers or are they expecting me to call them back, I wonder?
Oh, no, that was...
They're texts.
Oh, they're texts.
Yeah,
So how do we...
Just, if you want to read them, you go into...
Yeah, I'll read them. Why not?
There you go.
Tiny, tiny print.
Oh, yes, that's from... It doesn't say who it's from. Actually, if people put their name...
Yeah, I can address you by name if you leave me your name.
Yeah.
Is it true? Oh, it's moved again. No, is it true that Chris Kenny is saying that he was readily available all this time? I don't know. I can't tell you. I can't tell you. How do we get to some more texts?
Back to there.
We go back there. Okay.
Just pick the one.
Oh, I can read it from there, though, can't I?
You won't be able to get all of it, maybe.
All right.
So down 9 a.m. Great to see you back.
Oh, great to see you back. Thank you very much. I don't know who sent that, but thank you. I never went anywhere, really. Lovely to have you back on the airwaves. Jeremy Warmest wishes.
That's from Claire.
Claire, thank you.
We need to increase the text size on this, don't we?
Yeah, we can do that, can't we?
Yep.
Oh, okay.
No, not that one.
What's this one? It's only one page, Jeremy. The rest is made up of drafts and minutes used to prepare the actual one-page statement. Well, I don't know. Do you mean that what they did was to write the 26 pages and you would have me believe that they distilled it down, sanitised it, edited it, neutered it to be one innocuous page when what they really were talking about and meaning was all the stuff that's sitting here in front of me in this 26-page document? That would be rather deceptive, wouldn't it? Peter Credlin is not correct. This is the text I'm reading. She is going to be very embarrassed when this becomes apparent. Welcome back on the air, by the way. No, thank you. It's good to be back. I don't know. All I can say is that if the one page from which this document or to which this document has been distilled, if that one page, which is fairly reasonable, okay, but you go in and you look at the rest of it, then you really have got a document which declares war on White Australia. White Australia. There is a lot of it, and it's unfortunately, like my text thing over there, very small print. We gather at the 2017 National Constitutional Convention, coming from all points of the southern sky, to make this statement from the heart. Well, I always thought that if you were going to change the Constitution, it would be a good idea to have a constitutional convention. But we sort of skipped that and went straight to the referendum. But he does talk here a lot about our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander tribes were the first sovereign nations of Australia, the Australian continent, and its adjacent islands. And it goes on to say, according to this ancient, our ancestors, according to the reckoning of our culture, from the creation, according to the common law, from time immemorial, and according to science more than 60,000 years ago. See, I don't know that that makes any sense. But he talks about the 1788, the first fleet arriving and all of that. Then he talks about the resentment that they felt. I can quite understand that. But the tragedy is, and it always will be, if you cannot control your boundaries, your borders, it doesn't matter who you are. If Australia, as we know, this multicultural continent, this multicultural country at the moment, if we could not control our borders, we would lose our country. And this is the simple moving and shifting and changing that every country, every civilization has had to live with from the beginning of time. I mean, this is my land. Well, it's only my land if I can keep it, if I can defend it, and I can get rid of people who might want to come and live here. I do want to talk to you about the situation later involving refugees or asylum seekers. It's a huge problem. You know, I don't know if you follow it or have any interest in it, but the number of people who are streaming out of Tunisia. Libya used to be the main port that they left Africa, and I would not mind, I would not object to these people trying to get the hell out of Africa. It's quite understandable. But anyway, people smugglers will take money and they will provide, I don't know what you'd say, maybe a 10% chance of getting to Italy or getting to Greece. Not much more than that, but obviously what you are leaving behind in Africa is so awful, you'd take any risk and pay anything to get the hell out of there. But if you've got 20 million people, and mostly from the poorer countries of the world, particularly Africa, you've got 20 million people on the move at any one time, all looking for a better place to live. And who could blame them? Who could blame them? But the idea of England putting them on a barge, and I think they're going to put 500 of the, well, it's a greater number than 500. I think the 500 are going to be symbolic of the sort of welcome refugees or asylum seekers will get in Britain, and they hope probably that that'll put people off trying. But it probably won't. You know, I. It's human nature, I suppose, to try and find a better life. It really is. Anyway, telephone number 0491 65 68 60 if you'd like to join us. Commonwealth Bank records a very good profit, $10.2 billion. But before you get excited, that money goes to the shareholders. You've got to know that, and you've got to accept that. But if you do, if you listen to the media, it seems like there are, you know, these greedy, well, they're well paid, and they'd want to be too. You don't want numbskulls running your banks. But here are these greedy people who are making $10.2 billion a year profit. Well, it isn't like that. I don't care how it looks. It isn't like that. That money goes into the pockets of shareholders, mums and dads, mum and dad investors, into the superannuation funds of Australia. Now, this profit is good. You don't want unprofitable banks, believe me. Now, did that call just disappear?
I think they stopped calling.
Don't stop calling. When you call, give me a few seconds because I might be in the middle of something and I'll come to you as quickly as I can. Now, I don't have to put this over here or anything, do I? No. Just as long as we can have some sort of contact with people. But just on the subject of the Commonwealth Bank, this is so close to libel or slander, defamation as you can possibly get. It says, bank robs man. This is very clever. Very clever. Authorities are searching for a bank thought to be responsible for a spate of robberies totaling more than $10.2 billion. Well, we know what you're getting at. We know what you're getting at. In a sign of its brazen behaviour, the bank is said to have boasted about the robberies online, releasing a post entitled Profit Update to Shareholders. Yeah, well, look, I just don't get it. Do you want to have banks that lose money? If you're a shareholder, or if you are a self-funded retiree, or you have superannuation, I would have thought the go-to investment would be the banks of Australia. You don't want them falling over and you don't want them being not profitable, for God's sake. Virgin Galactic. That man must have an ego. What do you mean, must have an ego? Anyway, Virgin Galactic. He's taken his first space tourists up and, most importantly, brought them back safely. Not cheap. $600,000 a ticket. Tony, would you do that?
Sounds like another Titan.
Yes, another Titan. Why would you stick your neck out? All right, I know people. Some people are much more adventurous than we are. But it does strike me as strange. Nothing wrong with being adventurous, but you put your hand in your pocket and you cough up, or you find $600,000. Although the former Olympian, the gentleman who has Parkinson's, who went up, he bought his ticket, oh, I don't know, 20 years ago or something, and he paid $200,000. Only $200,000! Oh, God, look, all right. It must have been lovely to just look out that window and see this beautiful blue disc hanging in the blackness of space. Must have been beautiful, but worth $600,000? Well, I suppose this first flight, let me think. The first ticket was bought 20 years ago for $200,000, and the other two tickets, three passengers. It's a lot of trouble for the three people. Anyway, they won their ticket in a sweepstakes. So real paying customers, I think, might be at $600,000 a little thin on the ground. Aldi has been voted the best supermarket in Australia for the sixth year in a row. Aldi. Good, different. Yeah, it's interesting how they have managed to sort of find this niche. You'd have looked at the supermarket scene in Australia and you'd have thought, well, we're well catered for. We've got lots of supermarkets.
I have some lovely Aldi crackling pork last night.
Aldi crackling pork. I'm on a diet. I can't do that sort of thing anymore. Anyway, speaking of diets, they won the best meat pie, the best sausage roll, the best hot cross bun, the best vanilla slice. Lovely. I love vanilla slices. Yes. What are those other ones with the pink icing on the top and coconut and the mince, fruit mince in the middle? What are they called? Are they called Chester cakes?
There's fruit mince pies.
Fruit mince pies. Now they're a bit different. I think they're.
What are you talking about?
I think it's a Chester cake.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah. Hey, listen, guys, up there, and I tell you what, they're in the Adelaide Hills, at Belair. Their bakery is called the Banana Boogie. Really? The Banana Boogery. The Banana Boogie Bakery. Anyway, congratulations. That's a mean feat, isn't it? That's very good. Best meat pie, best sausage roll, best hot cross bun, best vanilla slice. Now all you got to do is to conquer the Chester cake. Can you do that? The radio. Yeah, she ain't a Cadillac and she ain't a Rolls, but there ain't nothing wrong with the radio. Absolutely. Yes, my mind is still hovering around the Chester cakes. Strange reason. Hey, listen, the same week that Barbie takes $1 billion at the box office, $1 billion. By the way, in Kuwait, they have banned Barbie. Why the hell would they ban Barbie? I would have thought it would have been a fairly innocuous sort of piece of fantasy entertainment. Is it? Well, I suppose Kuwait is a very staunch Islamic country. Maybe they think Barbie is a bit provocative. I don't understand it. Anyway, same week they took $1 billion and got banned. We look at 100 days into the screenwriters and actors' strike. No end in sight. The weird thing, you know, with this, is that on day one, if the studio had given them what they wanted, which seems to me to be pretty reasonable, it would have been far cheaper for the studios. You know, you'd imagine they'd have accountants and all kinds of people who could work that out. I mean, what? Let us not shoot ourselves in the foot. Why wouldn't they think laterally? Neither side looks like giving in. And I was hoping that Anne... Well, Anne still might turn up. I'm not sure. But anyway, she might. She Anne Peters is a brilliant lady. She runs a talent organisation. And there are many people in the movies and in radio and in voiceovers and theatre who owe their very existence in the entertainment world to Anne Peters. Wonderful. And Ian's still working hard, but today not terribly well. Woke up with no voice and a bad throat, but she said she'd try. And I appreciate that, Anne. But, you know, the one thing we can count on all the time is change. You know, you can be frightened of it. You may even try to avoid it, but it's inevitable. And as I think I said in one of the podcasts the other day, the only mistake that the invincible dinosaur made was that he was so big and so powerful and been around so long, the only thing he felt was that he didn't have to change. He didn't. And, of course, the rest is history. Sad for the dinosaur, but a lesson in life, I would think. But we like to hang on to the things that are familiar. Now, I must admit to you, I probably would have hung on to the old-fashioned radio, the conventional radio that I'd known all my life. I'd have hung on to that because it was familiar. I knew my way around. Well, after 60 years, if you don't know your way around, you'll never ever find your way around. But the thing is, that change was forced on me. But here I sit and I realise I have been, you know, in a blessed sort of fortunate way, shown the future. I love it. There are a few little wrinkles to be worked out, but Tony Denton and Andy Martin and Peter Clayton, who may be coming through the door, I don't know. Yeah, there he is, right on cue. These people showed me a completely different way. I don't know if I've told you the story. Maybe I did in the early days when I was doing the Facebook page from the garage. Peter Clayton came to me and he said, look, why don't you... You did that Court of Public Opinion thing on Channel 44, and that was good. You got sponsors and it was successful. And I said, yeah. And he said, well, why don't you just revive that and put it on Facebook? And I had a camera down there and I had it sort of set up for nothing more than show, nothing more than appearances. And it was a lovely Canon camera that had the ability to take movies. And then Tony Denton thought, well, you know, we need some lights and what we need is some maybe a teleprompter so that if you don't lose your way, because I do make notes and try to not forget where I am. And if you guys hadn't said to me, look, just do it. I wanted to do it mostly just to keep my mind working, because I think it's a dangerous thing at my age. Dangerous thing is to not be stimulated or stimulate yourself. Keep your mind working. Keep the wheels turning. But getting back to the actors' strike, that is going to have incredible effects. Not just the the writers and the lighting people and the sound people, and of course the actors. A few of them make very good money. Most of them don't. I think most people are in show business because they love it. It's wonderful. It's exciting. It's frightening. It's dangerous, and it's not always rewarding. But you do it because it's kind of somehow, I don't know, in your blood. And you know, the most interesting, gifted people I've heard on radio, and I, you know, you can go to radio and indeed hear an awful lot of people who are not gifted and wonderful, but that's okay, that's all right. That's it's a broad church, but it's also the people who are on the outside, you know, the peripheral people, because there are caterers and there are all kinds of other businesses that come forward from, spring from, the business of show business. And it's a nice way to earn a living. But these people must really be wedded to the idea that they are going to die if artificial intelligence can steal their appearance or can steal their voice. I would have thought that technology would have been able to get ahead. The law, unfortunately, lags behind technology, but surely you could patent or trademark your voice, or you could patent or trademark your appearance. I know that Harley Davidson have the sound of a Harley Davidson motorbike, the exhaust sound, I mean. They've got that patented or trademarked. If you can do that, you should be able to do anything. The click on a camera could be anything. You just got to try. Yes, speaking of things on the road, used car prices down 15% on last year. I don't know if you've tried to sell a car or not, but you might not get the money this year that you would have got last year. And this year, electric car sales are down 25%. That is something that isn't going to be talked about in mainstream media, because there is this kind of subtle approach, or whatever you can call it, censorship maybe, that says, no, we all want people to get into electric cars. Yes, we do.
You keep lying when you ought to be truthing, and you keep losing when you ought to not bet. You keep saying when you ought to be a-changing. Now what's right is right, but you ain't been right yet. These boots are made for walking, and that's just what they'll do. One of these days these boots are gonna walk all over you.
Yeah, I had a phone call just in the middle of that. Unfortunately, she didn't or he didn't stay. So please, look, ring me back. 0491 6560. Yeah, 0491 6560
860. G'day, this is Dr. Carl. I hope you're enjoying the show. Don't forget my fabulous new book, Dr. Carl, The Universe and Everything, and bring on Dr. Jeremy.
You've got the radio on and it's just me and you. We'll talk for a while and share a song or two. If you've got a troubled mind or some spare time to spend, with the radio on, you know you've got a friend.
You certainly have. That was Peter Clayton, by the way, who sang that for me. Hello, Groovers. Okay. What does this say? What happened to Thomas Mayo, the golden boy who wrote the book on The Voice? Surely he can explain in the most basic, direct terms exactly what The Voice will do. Great. But when he started answering simple questions about it, he explained that it was a precursor to a treaty, truth-telling, non-Indigenous Australians paying the rent reparations and compensations. Yes, I have. Who sent me this? Nick? Anyway, I have heard people say this, that it is the precursor to reparations and paying the rent and compensation and all that stuff. The list and the hatred of non-Indigenous Australians goes on and on. Did Albo sweep him under the rug? Where is he? It looks like it to me. Funny that. Okay. Thank you, Nick. I'll put that over there. All good. Oh, speaking of things, prices going up and down. I don't know if you've noticed it, but fruit and vegetable prices down 50% on this time last year. Now, what could... I suppose that must have been the floods. That would have had to have been the floods, wouldn't it? But 50%, if you go to your greengrocer or your supermarket, you'll find a bargain or two there, I would think. Those annoying scooters, you know, you'll find them in just about every city in Australia. I don't know about overseas. I imagine they're the sort of thing that you'd find everywhere these days. I don't like them. I really don't. I think they're dangerous and ugly and messy. In Melbourne, they have got a second-generation scooter. Yeah, second-generation, smarter scooter. And you know what it does? It's got a camera in it, and it's got other sensors, and it yells at you on the scooter. It does. It yells at you if you do anything wrong. Well, all I can say is that there's going to be an awful lot of yelling. You're not allowed to do this and you're not allowed to do that, but, you know, you pick the thing up and you've got a helmet, and God knows who's been wearing the helmet before you wearing the helmet. I don't know what you're going to catch out of that, but it'd be a random sort of chance that you're taking with the helmet. Well, hell, you must be an adventurous soul anyway to get on a scooter. Anthony Toop's going to join us later on. I've known Anthony just about all my Adelaide life, and he is one of those very successful businessmen. He's walked away from his business. He's sort of passed it on to the next Toop generation. But he rides a motorcycle, and I've never quite understood. Anthony, I just don't know why you sort of stick your neck out like that. This lovely house here, which I told you the story, you probably weren't listening last week, and I don't even know if you're listening now, but we did a soft opening of the Court of Public Opinion online last week, last Friday, and we had a few guests. We had Professor Ian Plimer, who was wonderfully enlightening on climate change, and... who else do we have? The wonderful Dr. John Bruni, who talked to us about everything from Ukraine to China and all the rest. But anyway, one of the things we touched on was the fact that this house, I came from Sydney, and for years and years and years, I kept the house in Sydney. And I suppose it's just that sort of instinctive safety net feeling that people have, because you stick your neck out, you come to a completely different city, and every city has its own kind of mentality, its own tastes, and you don't really know whether you're going to fit in or not. So you try to take out a bit of insurance, because I didn't know whether I would have to go back or whatever would happen. Show business is full of risk. And nobody really gives you any guarantees. I mean, even if you've got a contract, it doesn't really mean very much at all. So you've got to look after yourself. And it is a changing world. Technology, and technology is a major thing. Of course, it's changing. But many other things change. Management changes. And, you know, you can get along wonderfully well with the boss, and then suddenly... he's been sent to New Zealand or something, and you've got a completely different character who doesn't like you. Now, all of that sort of thing, you've got to factor in and take precautions. This is a long way around saying I kept my house in Sydney until I was satisfied after, I don't know, 30 years that I wouldn't be going back to Sydney. And or if I did, I'd just go on a limited basis time wise. So I decided I'd sell the house. So I sold the house, and you know what Sydney prices are like. Anyone who is listening to me in Sydney or Melbourne, and you want to come and buy a house that's much better than the one you've got there for half the price, you should do it. Now, who's this on the phone? Hello? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? It's a private number. I get that. Hello? Now, why can't I hear that call? Just persevere with me for a second, and we'll find out why we're not getting that. Well, I can hear you at a distance.
Coming now.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? That's odd, isn't it, Tony?
Settings change themselves.
So, yeah, I mean, the whole thing changed itself overnight, funnily enough. Now, what is that doing? I can hear something there, something.
Just try ringing back.
Have we lost you?
It's on there.
Have we lost you? Have we lost you? You see, the thing about it is you can't test run these things. You've got to do them in actual fact, live. And on the first day, you are going to find all sorts of hitches. Although last week we didn't really have a problem, though, did we? Is it sort of not plugged in, maybe?
No, it's connected.
It's connected?
It's all connected.
You just hang on that line there and we'll try and find...
Ringing back. Just ring in again.
Oh, could I ask you to ring in again, if you can hear me still? If you can ring in. This is called a shakedown, ladies and gentlemen. You know, you do this with cars and aeroplanes and all kinds of things. So why not a radio station? Have we paid the bill? Be awfully embarrassing if they cut off the phone.
I reckon the volume was
enough. Okay, okay. Hello? Hello? Say something. That's sort of buffeting, isn't it? Oh, dear. I don't get it. Because it worked, sort of. It was a little bit bumpy last week, but we certainly got calls to air, and we thought we didn't really have to do too much more to the telephone. It seemed to be okay. Hello? Hello? I know that you enjoy things when they go wrong much more than when they're as smooth as silk. You know, and it's fun. There's Cordeaux sitting there with egg all over his face. Do you think we need a different telephone? Maybe we could go to one of those old-fashioned radio stations and steal one of those...
Throw the whole thing out after today.
No. So we'll be all right. So the telephone is connected, we know that. But we can't seem to... Join the dots. Hello? Hello? Oh, now I can hear you. I can hear you very faintly. So something's going on. Do you think if we called Telstra, maybe they'd come in? We don't have to have any of these buttons down the bottom. That's all right. That's all right. Oh, dear. Because this is one of the big things when we were planning this program, because we had to have, however we did it, we had to have a telephone so we could talk to each other. Yeah, we can have guests and we can have bits of music and so forth, but there's nothing like the telephone. Oh, dear, that is disappointing. But it's nothing over which we cannot get. You know the history of the telephone on... broadcasting, the history of people who thought, well, you know, it'd be really good to get listeners to ring up the radio station and have the novelty of going on air. And you'd have a whole new sort of resource. That is, you know, people commenting on and arguing with you. And all of that can be very entertaining.
I can hear you.
You're going to ring me. But why can't I hear you?
Right, so I can hear you, but that is strange.
You see, there are some There are some broadcasters who would love it that way. So all they do, ring up. You can hear the person, but the person can't hear you.
I can hear Jeremy here.
Yeah. It's all right, ladies and gentlemen. Be patient, because this is a radio station in the making.
This is when you'd reboot the whole thing.
Oh, you reboot. You turn it off. Turn it on again. I've heard that before. No. I'll just sit here with my mug of green tea and not worry too much about it. But I do want to talk to you, so I can promise you that we will be working very hard on getting this right for next week. And I'm sure it's fixable, because we've had it working.
It's working.
Yep, we know that it works. Absolutely no reason why it can't. You don't think that other mob would have sabotaged us, do
John
you?
John Blake's done
something. Yes, John Blake. John Blake did this.
So I can hear you. You can't hear me.
You know, because he is a technical. I see that pumping noise is a bit funny too, isn't it?
Is it something to do behind you?
Or is this it here?
That's Jeremy.
What's this one here?
See, that's not coming from. It's from Jeremy. No, we haven't got a.
This is a bit like climbing out on the wing of an aeroplane and fixing the flaps while you're flying at 20,000 feet. I'll try to make it more entertaining. Perhaps if I take my clothes off. Just talk amongst yourselves while we try and sort this out. See, Tony is an absolute whiz at these things, and he will not let this beat him. It has to be fixed. We have to have phone calls. I mean, we've got that great number. I love that number, 0491 65 68 60. It's a good number. It's having a sort of a conniption.
Play some music.
Play some music? No. I'll tell you the story of how we got telephones or telephone calls to air originally. I think probably 2GB would have been the first station to do it. 5DN, I know, was doing it about the same time, because 5DN here in Adelaide was owned by 2GB in Sydney. And what they did was to get people, they'd have a guest, you know, it'd be an eye doctor, or it would be an architect or a town planner or something. And they would say to the audience, we have so-and-so coming in. If you have any questions about your garden, for example, just ring in, and we'd have a panel operator in the other studio, and he would record, because you were not allowed to put live telephone calls to air. That was absolutely verboten by the all-powerful PMG. PMG was around long before Telstra, as some of you may well remember. Now, that was kind of like an at-your-service program where people could ring up and ask questions. But the holy grail to the whole thing was just getting people to ring up spontaneously and come on the air. And the big objection the PMG had was the quality, because they didn't like the idea that the sound from a telephone, and we'd be talking old, you know, we'd be talking 1960, we'd be talking Bakelite, you know, Bakelite telephones. The quality of the microphone in those phones was not good. It got you there, but that was about the size of it. So the great compromise was, I think the industry talked the PMG into allowing the phone call to go to air, but it had to be delayed. And the delay was 7 seconds. They figured that if somebody rang up and defamed someone or used a four-letter word or whatever, the broadcaster would have 7 seconds. And it's amazing what you can do in 7 seconds. But 7 seconds was enough to allow you to kill the call, hit the panic button, you know, reject, eject, whatever. And that worked kind of well. They did have... The way they did it, though, was kind of amazing, because to get a seven-second delay, they had to put the entire broadcast that you were doing... They had to put the entire broadcast through... You look excited. Do you think you fixed it?
We know what it is. The phone's gone into a different mode.
Oh, the phone. See, this is what happened to the whole thing. The whole thing overnight went into a different mode, which is why we couldn't broadcast at 9 o'clock.
We've got to check it before in future.
We'll have to check it before. Okay.
We play a nice tune.
You want me to play a tune, huh? Whipped cream and other delights. He was great. A marvellous man of music, Herb Alpert. Herb Alpert, he was not only a great trumpet player, but he, was it Jerry Moss, put together A&M Records, Alpert and Moss. And A&M had some wonderful stars on it in its time. He also had a good voice, not a great voice, Herb Alpert, I mean. He had one hit, which was a great song called This Guy's in Love with You. Do you remember that? Hey, This Guy's in Love with You. Pete, do you remember This Guy's in Love with You? You don't? Hell, you and I are about the same age. How could you not remember This Guy's in Love with You? This is a great song. Oh, I don't know what I'm going to do with you. Radio! When you can't find a friend, you still got the radio. That is good. We might be making some progress here.
Battling on, yeah.
You know, I saw something interesting the other day. Cigarettes are now $50 a packet. $50 a packet. Why would anyone spend $50 to wreck his health? But clearly people do. And they've tried everything they possibly can. Of course, they could just ban them. I wonder what it costs in terms of the health budget to try and do something about people who really kind of willfully damage their health. Such a thing as personal responsibility, isn't there? Personal responsibility. Take responsibility. If you want to go and smoke, I don't know why you should be able to go into hospital and avail yourself of Medicare. You know, you don't have to do that. You don't have to get on a scooter. You certainly don't have to get on Virgin Galactic. You certainly don't have to hop into the Titan and go down and look at the...
Hello.
Hello.
You, but you can't hear me.
No, I can hear you, but it's not through the phone. Oh. Now, there's a noise to conjure with.
No, it's not coming. The audio is not coming out of that.
No, there's no audio from the telephone. Is it too late to take it back?
Well, I think I might actually. Thanks, Murray. I'll try that.
Okay, we'll try that. Hang on.
Can you hear that?
Can I hear that? No, I can hear you because you're in the same room and you're talking on the phone. If we could get 355,000 people into this room, it's not a small room. It's okay. Well, I thought it was a nice big room, but when you look around it now, I've got so much stuff in here, I don't know.
I think we've got a faulty phone, certainly not.
A faulty phone? Well, look, I think I'd feel
there's
better about that.
Right? So that should be.
Hmm. But that's your master gain, is it?
Yeah, that's for the incoming court.
Yeah.
That's just not working for some reason.
No. Oh, well, do we just give that up as a bad thing?
I think for a while. We might have to.
Yeah, well, there you go. I mean, it's just one of those things, and I do apologise, but it's beyond our control. Yeah, we'll get a different phone and try that. Now, what's that noise? It's sort of trying. It's sort of trying, isn't it? Hello? Hello? Hey, I've got
hello.
You. Hello?
Hello. Good morning.
Good morning. Who's that?
You've got Gavin down in here in Tasmania.
Oh, Gavin, bless your heart. Thank you for persevering. I appreciate that very much. Now, the mystery now is why I can get a call from Tasmania and I can't get one from the other bloody room. That's extraordinary.
It's the Marinus link.
The Marinus link? I'm not sure what that is. But I'll go along with it.
Listen.
Was there something in particular you wanted to say?
Right. What I wanted to tell you is that down here in Tasmania, we have now got apartheid.
Oh, yeah. Well, I tell you what, we've got the beginnings of it all over the place.
Yes. Well, I just wanted to tell you about what appeared in the local paper.
Yeah, tell
and
me.
And that is the government is providing a scholarship of $5,000 to young Aboriginal Tasmanians, the age between 15 and 29.
But I don't know. You can't do that, can you? That is discrimination. You can't discriminate on the basis of the colour of somebody's skin and give them, because they're black, something that you wouldn't give to a white person.
Well, both. You could have two students sitting side by side in a classroom.
Yeah.
Both of them would have the same coloured skin, probably as white as snow, but one identifies as an Aborigine. And so they can get the $5,000, but the other one who doesn't identify as an Aborigine misses out.
Well, it's not Australian, is it? It's not even logical.
No.
It's not logical.
No.
Well, who is driving this nonsense, I wonder? It can't just be the Labor Party. It can't just be Albanese. There's more to it than meets the eye.
Yes, well, this fellow is a Liberal minister.
Yeah.
Roger Jantsch is his name. I've written to him and asked him to explain it, but I haven't got an answer yet.
Oh, well, I'd love you to ring me back and tell me what his answer was, if he can give you one. But this document, this Uluru Statement from the Heart, is littered with things that you would not be able to say if you were a white person talking about black people or Aboriginal people. There seems to be two completely different laws. There's a law for black and there's a law for white, and that's not what Australia is about.
Yes. Well, it's great to be able to get through to you and talk to you when you're having so many problems with your phone, but you're coming through very clearly. And I would just like to say before I go, I am I've just mentioned to you one item, but I am completely annoyed when I land in the aeroplane. They're paying respects to Aborigines, past and present. They don't give any credence to the pioneers that settled this place and cleared the land and so that we can have beautiful food from the crops that's grown on it. They don't get a mention.
No.
So I'm just over it, and I fear what's going to happen in this country, because I've got a lot of friends and acquaintances who are just getting totally sick and tired of this rubbish.
Well, it might have a terribly adverse effect. It might have a reverse effect. These people trying to achieve their goal, they may in fact annoy the majority of Australians that they damage everything. You know, the truth of the matter is that we should have one egalitarian, equal country. We all have the same advantage, the same opportunity. And if you look at what has happened over the years, the Aboriginal Affairs Department, they have $35 billion a year. And on top of that, there are various people who have mining royalties, which account for tens of millions of dollars a year, if not hundreds of millions of dollars a year. And you've got welfare, and you've got the advantage, if you're an Aboriginal person and you tick that box. And I don't know why, I think that's racist in itself. You're an Australian. You know, you it doesn't matter what football team you barrack for or what suburb you live in or what nationality your cousins are. You just have one simple box, and it's Australian. Anyway, if you take all that money and divide it between the 500,000 or 600,000 Aboriginal people who represent 3% of the population, you've got an average income per week of about $1,300 or $1,400 per person per week. Now, if you've got a house, and many houses do have more than 10 people, you have got probably the wealthiest group of people in the country. Nothing to complain about. But I hasten to say that I don't believe that the average Aboriginal person is getting any of that money. It just goes to the industry.
Yes, yes.
Anyway, do let me know if you get that letter back, will you?
I sure will. I will wait with bated breath.
Thank you very much for the call.
Thank you for listening to me.
And thank you for persevering. You know, I sit here and we can't explain. I mean, not my intelligence, but between you guys, you have a super brain. And we still don't know why we got that call through and we couldn't get the others. Oh, well, let's try it again, folks. Here we go. Hello? Hello? Don't do this to me. Hello? Oh, hang on.
Hello, Jeremy. Can you hear me?
Yes, I've got you. I've got you. I've got you. Where are you calling me from?
Well, you've just had a call from Tasmania, now you're having one from Tokyo.
Oh, God. Huh. Welcome. Welcome.
How are you, Jeremy?
I'm very well indeed. How's everything in Tokyo?
Hot and humid. And, it's a bad time of the year up here with the weather. The bottom end of Japan have been hammered with heavy rains. And, in fact, over a three-day period, some areas were expecting and did get up to 700 to 800 millimetres of rain.
Good God. That's almost a flood, isn't it?
It's incredible.
Yeah,
it's more than a flood, yeah. It's sort of, unfortunately, it causes a lot of landslides and, houses getting washed away, etc. Rivers breaking their banks, and it's just terrible.
Well, you'll never.
We actually have a typhoon that's heading our way now, and should be approaching us within the next couple of days.
Well,
apart from that, everything's fine. Well, not to mention the earthquakes, of course.
No, we'll never have a dull moment with regard to the weather. They tell me we're coming out of an ice age, and things are getting warmer, but it's exactly what's meant to happen, because this is the cycle that we call the life of the living, breathing, evolving, changing Earth.
That is true. Now, incidentally, your voice coming over is a little bit warbly, but I can still understand what you're saying. So I just thought I'd let you know that.
No, good. Thank you for that. Yeah, no, that you're as clear as a bell.
Talking about the temperature, since the 7th of July, which is over a month ago, our maximum temperature has only been below 30 degrees once.
Mm-hmm.
Would you believe? And the last 6 nights, the minimum temperature at midnight, or the temperature at midnight, was all above 26.6 degrees.
Mm-hmm. I guess air conditioning would feature in the homes of most Japanese people, I would think.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we've got it here, but, I can't stand it on for too long because it gets very stuffy inside.
Yeah,
with air conditioning. So we've got to sort of put up with it, with fans, et cetera.
When are you getting back to Australia?
We're hoping to get back there sometime next year for sure.
Oh, good.
I just thought I'd bring you up just to let you know that I'm tuning in, and apart from the little hiccups that you've had with those phones, it's great to hear you back on the airwaves.
No, thank you very much. Now, I think the hiccups are to be expected because we are dealing, well, I am dealing in particular with something that's quite different to the old style or the old-fashioned style of radio that I'm used to. But technically, we'll get this nailed, and I'm glad the phone is up and running. Thank you, dear boy.
Well, it's up and running. Just your that little bit sort of a warbly voice. That's all.
Yeah, but I call it buffeting. Yeah, I know what you mean. I know. But it's
all right. We'll enjoy the rest of the morning.
All the best.
I'll talk to you again down the track.
All right. I look forward to that. God bless you. You have a great day.
Hi there. You're listening to the Court of Public Opinion with Jeremy Cordeaux.
You've got the radio on and it's just me and you. We'll talk for a while and share a song or two. If you've got a troubled mind or some spare time to spend, with the radio on, you know, you got a friend.
Kind of amazing to sit here, you know, and get calls from Tasmania and Tokyo. And if you look, because you can tell who is listening and where, and we've got listeners in South America, we've got listeners in South America, in Africa, in Europe, all over the place. It's amazing. And you couldn't do that with a old-fashioned radio station. If you were lucky at night and you had an AM radio station, the signal tends to go a long, long way, but that's something to do with the atmospherics. This, however, is a completely different kettle of technological fish. It certainly is. I started telling you about this house and how I came to have it. And I was just saying that I didn't sell my house in Sydney for a long, 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 long time. Anyway, when I did sell it, I decided that I wouldn't do anything more with the money than put it in another house, because I've always been lucky with houses. I sort of move into a house and I stay there for 40 years. And in 40 years, you get a nice lot of capital growth if you're lucky. And as I say, I have been lucky. But anyway, I saw this house, and I thought, it's old. Looks old. This is the house from which we are broadcasting, jeremycordeaux.com, the dining room table. Anyway, I looked at the house and I thought, it's an old house. Then I looked closer and it's not an old house. It was one of those houses that David Cheney made, built, designed. He was a very interesting man. I think I got to meet him once. Only a young man, but you would see David Cheney designs everywhere. In fact, I'm looking out my dining room window right now, and on the other side of the road, next to Tony Denton, It's a very incestuous little neighbourhood, this. Could be a patent place with a bit of effort. Anyway, next door to Tony is another one of David Cheney's houses, but that one is in the old Australian colonial design. You know, it's a sort of square design, but great big veranda at the bottom, and a veranda separating the first floor from the second floor. It's a lovely, lovely house, red brick it's stone with red brick coins, you know, the bits down the side. But that was one of the designs. But you see his kind of genius all over the city. He built a lot of homes. This one is a sort of more of a Victorian design, but with Australian adaptations. And by that I mean verandas. You've got to have verandas. I don't know about modern architecture at all, but the housing designs that I see coming up, the new houses that are being built, they are square boxes, just like a cube. And I wonder, in this climate, people talk about climate change and how we have to do this and that and the other thing. Wouldn't it be a simple thing to go back and look at the way our forefathers designed houses? They didn't have air conditioning. They had to design houses to make the most of the climate. And the way you did it was to have nice, big, airy, wide, high verandas. That should never have stopped, but it certainly is not the design fashion of today. And I guess if you're going to live in that little box, it could well become a hot box if you didn't have air conditioning. And the air conditioning, I think that probably costs a lot of money, probably damages the environment. I don't know. Anyway, I digress slightly. I was going to tell you about Anthony Toop, who's going to drop by around 11 o'clock. He and David Cheney, I think, have the same love of motorbikes. And I understand, very terribly sad, David Cheney had a whole wonderful life behind him and a brilliant life ahead of him. And he was on his motorbike down the end of Sunnyside Road, where Sunnyside Road joins up with the Southeastern Freeway. If you're an Adelaide person, you'd know sort of what I mean. And for some reason, he was, I don't know, showing off or something. And he got his bike up on its back wheel and just lost control of it for a second. He shot off into oncoming traffic and was killed instantly. And that was the end of a brilliant talent in the beat of a heart. But I don't know, Anthony, I'll ask you when you get here, but I don't know why people ride motorbikes. It just seems to me to be such a provocative, dangerous thing to do. You know, and riding scooters, probably about the same. Some other things that you might like to talk about. Plenty to talk about. 0491 65 68 60, I say with a degree of trepidation. But if it's working, it's working. Now, I'm not going to tempt fate by trying to find out why it wasn't working. As long as it is working, that's all we have to worry about. That's all we have to worry about. Restaurant takings. I don't know what this indicates. Restaurant takings down 16%. And that doesn't matter whether it's an upmarket restaurant or it's a corner cafe. Could be COVID, maybe. Hangover from COVID. Habit is a big thing. If you're used to going to a place, you're used to going to a place and then suddenly you don't. Somebody says, "Hi, Jeremy." "Hi, Jeremy. Great to have you back." Somebody else says, "Welcome back. Have you a new..." "Have you a new..." I shouldn't have touched this thing, should I? "Welcome back." That's from David. Thank you. "Hi, Jeremy. Great to hear your voice back on radio. Making sense as usual. Thank you." Oh, hang on. We got a call. Hello.
Welcome. Hello, is that you, Joe?
It is. Welcome to the Court of Public Opinion.
Oh, thank you. And thank you so much. And don't worry about the hiccups. It'll all sort out.
Oh, those hiccups. Yes, I know. I just wish.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can, loud and clear. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Good. So it's coming good.
Oh, good, 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 good. I wish I had a glass of red wine instead of a cup of green tea.
I think you should get Toop to go and get you one.
Say it again.
I think you should get Pete to go and get you a glass of red.
I don't know. Pete is sitting up the other end of the table looking like he's praying.
Oh. It's all going to sort, and I'm so pleased that you're doing this, and I thank you so much.
No, it's a great honour to be able to do it, and it's just that some people around me had faith in the idea that we could take technology and do what, you know, romantically they did 100 years ago from a dining room table just down the road. So it can
That's
be done.
Correct.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. I won't keep you. I've got to go out. I've got an appointment, but I tried and tried to get you. I'm pleased I got you at last.
Well, thank you very much, my darling. Thank you, thank you. Have a great.
You're welcome.
Have a great afternoon.
And you too. Thanks so much.
And a
bye.
And a great weekend.
Thank God for the radio. When I'm on the road, when I'm far from home, feeling blue. Thank God for the radio, playing all night long, playing all the songs that mean so much to me and you.
Yeah. I think that's Alan Jackson. I'm not really sure. But it's a lovely song. What do you want? You want to take that cup, which is my old 5DN, the Talk of Adelaide cup. And what are you giving me here?
A glass of...
Oh, there's no red wine in that. It's just green tea. More green tea. All right, okay, all right, all right. All right, all right, all right, already. I was reading some of these texts. You have a new voicemail from, message was left. There's a missed call there. So I think we're back on track, though. Thank you for your message, David. Appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. 0491-656860 in the Court of Public Opinion from the dining room table. Wendy's, I was talking about restaurants a couple of seconds ago. Anyway, Wendy's is coming to Australia, I read. They plan to open 200 new shops, cafes. It's funny, I seem to remember Wendy's being a sort of an ice cream parlour. There was a Wendy's, but maybe this is the real American Wendy's. There's got to be some difference because they say they're coming to Australia for the first time. Wendy's, whether they're still an ice cream store or that was just a knockoff, I don't know. But the Wendy's aren't here anymore, but they're on their way with restaurants and cafes and whatnot. A sad piece of news yesterday that Robbie Robertson died. Robbie Robertson was 80 years old. Back in the 60s, he had this thing, his group, it was called The Band. Do you remember The Band, Pete?
Yes.
And The Band was a backing group for Bob Dylan for years, and also Joan Baez. And indeed, Robbie Robertson wrote that wonderful song, which was called The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down.
Joan Baez.
Joan Baez, yeah. The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down. Yeah. The ABC, you know, I don't mean to be petty, but the ABC should start calling itself the Aboriginal Broadcasting Corporation. Because somehow, magically, in every news bulletin, every current affairs program, absolutely every aspect of their broadcasting presence in Australia seems to be devoted to including Aboriginal names and Aboriginal stories and Aboriginal scandals, Aboriginal anything. Why? Why? You know, here in Adelaide, the Aboriginals would be about less than 1% of the population. But no, we have to sort of be the ABC broadcasting from Ghana land. You know, rubbish, rubbish. Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. What in God's name leads them to believe that the taxpayer should be funding, and I think it's about $1 billion a year, $1 billion a year. The ABC, good God. And all they do is to run stuff, campaign. That's what they're doing, you know. They're not broadcasting, they're campaigning. I'm sorry, you're ridiculous. I really am. Pat Anderson, in fact, appearing on the ABC on 7:30 report on Wednesday night. You may have seen it. Yes. I don't know why. It's sort of like, I'm a bit like a moth in front of a flame when it comes to the ABC. I should just turn the bloody thing off. But I can't help myself. Anyway, 7:30 report Wednesday night displayed all, Pat Anderson, I mean, all of the aggressive sense of entitlement that some Aboriginal people do. Now, I couldn't quite come to grips with what her major complaint was. It seemed to be that she resented that at various intervals she and her colleagues had to appear before various committees in Canberra to justify the money that they were being given. And she resented this. You've got to be kidding. You've got to be kidding. Now, this lady felt that she was entitled to be given anything and everything she wanted without having to justify or account for a single penny. And, of course, what did we get from Sarah Ferguson? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Amazing stuff to listen to and watch. What makes you think you can walk in and demand billions of dollars from the taxpayers of Australia, which I argue never gets to the people for whom it was intended? It really is beyond belief. The ABC, yeah. Seven Star Constructions, I don't know anything about them, but Seven Star Constructions, and sadly half a dozen other building companies nationally, have gone through the hoop in the hands of the receivers. So before you sign up with any construction company to build anything, to repair anything, to renovate anything, please be very careful. Check it out carefully. Thanks to this government, even well-managed and well-established construction companies could be sailing through some very tough waters, sailing close to the wind. What else is around? 0491 65 68 60. Andrew Baldock's property in Kimber.
Yeah.
Great, great big property. Oh, hundreds of thousands of hectares. This is where they were going to set up the nuclear waste depository. Some call it a dump. Okay, fair enough. But the point is, it was perfectly safe. Perfectly safe for the people of Kimber, who wanted it. And many people regard it as just being simply a wasted opportunity for the township. And many Aboriginals probably wanted it as well. But no, somebody put his hand up and said, sacred site, sacred site. Gee, I don't know about sacred sites. I'm open-minded, I'm curious. But I remember the Hindmarsh Island debacle here in South Australia. I couldn't imagine, couldn't believe what was going on with that. The Hindmarsh Island fiasco. Now, as I remember the story, it was decided that it was something to do with secret women's business, and they were going to ban any development on Hindmarsh Island, but they couldn't explain to anyone why, because it was secret women's business. And we had, at the time, probably still do, a government that was compliant to that sort of nonsense. Absolute rubbish. You know, I can't tell you, it's secret women's business. Well, it might well be. But if you can't explain it, and you can't justify it, you expect us just to simply cop it, apparently. Yep. Well, it turned out that an aerial view, if you got up about 10,000 feet and you look down on the Coorong, Hindmarsh Island, you look down, it resembled the reproductive organs of a woman. Now, going back to the secret women's, I suppose that is the connection between the secret women's business and the reproductive organs of a woman. But going back to that, if it was something that had been around for a long time, sacred site-wise, I mean, how did the Aboriginals get up 10,000 feet to look down and see that particular perspective of Hindmarsh Island? That doesn't particularly seem to make any sense to me.
They had drones.
They had drones? Well, now you tell me. Oh, I did see that thing that they had on the television that said that they were the first scientists and they, you know, discovered astronomy and modern medicine and all that sort of stuff. So I suppose what you say might well be right. If the Aboriginal people had an objection to nuclear science or nuclear medicine, and we all benefit from nuclear medicine in Australia, I don't know, would they have an understanding as to what a nuclear waste dump was all about and whether it would be safe or whether it wouldn't be safe? And if it's not safe, what about where all that stuff is being stored right now, which is in the cellars and the lift wells and staircases of basements of places, buildings in North Terrace, in the city, in the square mile? If it's safe in the square mile of Adelaide, why couldn't it be safe out the back of, really, I won't say nowhere because I've been to Kimber. It's a nice place. There was an MG, many years ago, there was an MG run to Kimber. I think I've still got the T-shirt. We had little, beautiful little MGs flying across the country to Kimber. Some people, if we have any listeners in Kimber, might remember that all those years ago. Anyway, I'm sorry you've lost what would have been of considerable benefit to the community, that depository. And if it was safe and they could demonstrate that it was safe, and they obviously did to the satisfaction of a lot of people in the area. Yeah, I put my mind back to Lucas Heights in New South Wales, just outside Sydney. Well, it's a Sydney suburb, Lucas Heights, Sydney suburb. I can't remember there being a great big debate about whether or not they should build this nuclear reactor. I think it's something like 20 tiny, is it megatons that they get measured in? Mega something or other.
Nuclear bombs, isn't it?
Well, this is not a nuclear bomb. It's a nuclear reactor. But they can measure the size of the reactor or its capacity.
Being megawatts.
Megawatts, yeah. Well, 20 megawatts. Anyway, what it is the source of nuclear medicine in Australia, from which, as I say, we all benefit. Everybody. Where would we be without nuclear medicine? But, you know, you can't have nuclear medicine without the isotopes, and Lucas Heights supplies all of the isotopes for research and for medical treatment in the whole country. And God bless them for doing it. I see you've got people, suburban homes dotted all around Lucas Heights, all around that nuclear reactor. Anyway, I don't trust the people who just simply object to nuclear things. Bombs, I suppose, are pretty reasonable to object to. A nuclear war would be very good to object to. But I put my trust in the likes of Professor Harry Messel. And, you know, it's easy to be frightened of things you don't understand. That's probably very understandable.
Bigger than the Mississippi River near the ocean, wider than the desert and the Utah sky.
Hello, I'm Ray Martin. You're listening to Jeremy Cordeaux, and I hope you're loving the show. as I do.
Oh, thank you, Ray. I wonder what Ray's doing these days. Probably being happily retired. He's a nice bloke, Ray Martin. July, they say here, it's the hottest month ever recorded in history. I'll come back to that because we've got a call. Thank you very much. Thank you for the call. Hello? 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 Oh, don't you do this to me again. Hello? 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 Hello?
I think they hung up.
Oh, perhaps you hung up, so I won't panic just yet.
No.
Do give me a call, 0491 65 68 60. It is that simple. Where was I? I was telling about the hottest day of the month. Hottest day ever, I think they said. July. That day in July, but generally the hottest month ever recorded in history in the world. What absolute rubbish. I can't understand that. I really can't. If you listen to the show, if you listen last Friday to Professor Ian Plimer, you would have got a completely different perspective on it. I mean, where were the temperatures taken? The ocean, the mountains, the mountaintops, the deserts, the grasslands, the cities? How many temperatures were taken? How many sites at which the temperatures were taken? What time of day? The whole thing is a monstrous, stupid joke. It's a con. And that's not just me saying that. I am not a professor of climatology. But it tells you that it's a con because a man like Professor Plimer, is not talked to as often as he should be. And that is, yes, my opinion. But he offers a balance to the other extreme view on climate, which is all doom and gloom. I don't know if you've ever read Robert Lacey's book, which was called The Year 1000. If you have any curiosity about the veracity, the truth of all this climate stuff, have a look at that. Robert Lacey. He wrote a lot of books about the royal family, as I remember. I remember talking to him about the royal family. I think I might have talked to him about his book, The Year 1000. This is where he talks about pineapples. Pineapples that grew in the heart of London. Right? Pineapples that grew in the heart of London. It was a different climate. Huh. Rainforests in the centre of Australia. Land masses that moved. There were land bridges that joined various countries that are now separated by oceans. The climate was and is constantly changing, which has very little to do with mankind whatsoever. Mankind has had and probably made not a terribly great impression upon this little tiny fragile blue planet sitting there in the blackness of space. We've probably made a mess, you know, made a mess. But ultimately, the climate will change. Somebody told me that if you took mankind, I think they were talking particularly about New York, but if you took mankind out of the picture altogether, just gone, for whatever reason, pestilence, pandemic, war, whatever, it would be just 20,000 years before you would not find one scrap of evidence that he or she was ever there. Now, I couldn't quite understand how in 20,000 years the skyscrapers of New York would be gone, but everything would go back to nature. So man is here on sufferance. It wouldn't take much to go back to the way the planet was. I mean, I'm sure there are people who would really like that to happen. You know, Pol Pot was one of them. You know, if you had half a brain, you were going to be killed. Because we don't want people thinking. You know what happens if you have people with freedom of thought? The next thing you have is freedom of speech. They'll want freedom of speech. Can't have that. Ah. Yeah. A major push to move homes, your home, my home, our homes, away from gas. Again, these people are crazy. It's the same sort of story. To set up electricity instead of gas is going to cost you somewhere between $3,000 and $4,000 per house. There is an important place for gas in the homes of Australia. And isn't it strange that here we are blessed with this wonderful resource of gas that other countries really appreciate and pay top dollar for, and yet it is this really bad stuff, these really bad people producing a substance of great danger to the world and its future and its existence. It's hooey. Why do we let these people have the platform to talk this rubbish? Oh, you're the ABC. I'm sorry, of course. Well, you can't do very much about that, I suppose. They'll do what they want to do. But, you know, the Western Australian Labor government, they've got it down pat, really. No, they have no problem with gas. They sort of see it as the valuable resource that it is. It's a valuable resource to the community, and it's a valuable resource to the people who want to buy it overseas. And the government says, well, you can do whatever deal you like at whatever price you like with overseas countries, but when it comes to the local market, you will supply the local market first. And, oh, by the way, you'll do it at local prices. You won't do it at internationally competitive prices. Now, that is a smart government. That's a smart government. You know what it's doing? It's looking after the people. That is what a government should do. First rule of government should be, like the old medical slogan, do no harm. Do no harm. Talking about gas, AGL has lost over $1.3 billion. This is just in the last year. $1.3 billion thanks to the premature closing of gas-fired power stations. The road to renewables ain't easy. I'm sure that the size of our electricity bills, I'm sure the size of them is influenced by these businesses deciding to close coal-fired power stations or generators early. In other words, we are funding their venture into renewables. And I suspect it is being paid for by us, all of us, one way or another. And remember, Australia's contribution to global emissions is negligible, 1.3%. 1.3%, all of this expense and pain, for nothing, really, other than the government's ideological obsession with renewables and their stubborn, closed-minded stupidity, if not, what else could I describe it as? They refuse to embrace nuclear energy, really. No vision, that's their problem. They're very brave politically when it comes to this voice nonsense. But what's more important to them? That's what's more important to them. Cost of living is more important to us, I would suggest to you. But you probably wouldn't remember the way we eventually got Roxby Downs established. That was very hairy. You know, it was a very contentious time here in South Australia. We had this huge Western Mining, I'm pretty sure it was, Western Mining asset called Roxby Downs, this magnificent mine. Hang on. Hello? Hello? Hello?
Good morning. Good morning. Can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear. What's your first name?
Maria from Forest Range, a blast from the past.
Oh, Maria, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you very much. Welcome back to the airway, Jeremy.
Thank you, my darling. I'm very grateful that you called. Thank you.
Yeah, and all your supporters have been listening, you know, to you today. I know there's a little bit of gremlins in the works, yes. But don't worry. No. We will get it right.
We will get it right.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of sneaking into one of those old-fashioned radio stations tonight and stealing one of their switchboards for the telephone.
Right. Do you want some help?
I might. I might.
Okay.
Someone to hold the ladder steady.
Right.
Okay.
I'll be there.
All right, my darling. You have a wonderful weekend.
Yes, and just one moment. I just want to have a quick word at the moment, and I don't want to take up too much of your time.
No, please.
In regards to The Voice,
yeah,
it won't achieve anything, Jeremy.
No,
billions have been spent over the years. What benefit have we seen?
No,
I remind the people. Yeah, go on.
No, you go on.
Yeah, I remind the people. National Cabinet with 5 states and 2 territories. Face to face, they were all in agreement. They went back to their states and territories, and then everything went to mush. We have so many advisory boards at the moment. Do they listen to the people what we want? No.
Mm-hmm. No, they've probably got their own agenda. That goes for black Australia and white Australia, but I want one Australia. I want one flag. Yeah. I want one yeah. national concern. We've got a national parliament. Anybody, whether he or she is black or white or pink or yellow or whatever, everyone has the equal opportunity to enter parliament as a politician or to vote for a politician any way anyone likes. So we are all equal. Yeah. We don't want people yeah. creating different classes of
division.
People.
Division.
Yes. Division.
Division. Yes.
Division.
Did you watch Q&A and the point the other day?
No, I can't take Q&A because it's
no.
Go on.
I went off of it for a while, but this week, because they were up at Gama, I had to get as much information as I could.
Yeah.
And they want power. That's the bottom line. They yeah. want power. They want to divide white from black. And they want anything, like with this Kimber nuclear dump thing. They will take us to court, left, right and centre, and the country will be in a great big schmozzle.
Yeah, it's going to take leadership and it's going to take great wisdom and some patience. But we've got to do something about the people who have got a... It's a two-faced thing, you know. There's a smiling, presentable face of, we want to get on, but we want our rights and all the rest of it. And the other side of the face is that, as you say, they want open war with white Australia. And if we...
Yes,
and it's
yes.
not the ordinary Aboriginal person. He or she couldn't really care too much about that, I don't think. It's the activist. It's the white activists who are working and being highly paid, I might suggest, to work for the interests of the Aboriginals, and they're not. They're working for their own agenda.
Exactly. I totally agree with you, Jeremy. You know, in regards to the billions of dollars spent, we haven't seen a lot of improvement. And these people that want out in regional areas, a university, and they're complaining they don't have any teachers. Well, why would you have the oppressors teaching you? You know, they give you mixed messages with forked tongue. As you say, they want one thing one day and another thing the next day.
Hmm.
If you don't want colonisation and all the oppression and so forth, well, you can't have it both ways. If you want to have your own individual culture and so forth, well, you can't take our money. You've got to have your own indigenous money.
Hmm.
Why would you want sustainable supermarkets from us, the oppressors?
Yeah.
You know, you could live sustainable the way you did your ancestors.
Yes.
You can't have our way of life and then demand that it's no good.
Hmm. No, you make a lot of sense, Maria. I'm in love with you. You make a lot of sense. The thing is, the majority of people, I'm sure, would be in total agreement with you, but they never get heard.
Exactly. So I am just so happy that you have started this up so we can be heard. And all the rubbish at the moment, I'm getting quite ill. You know, everything's swayed to this Gamma and this and that, and they're all coming out of the woodwork. You know, I agree with you wholeheartedly, Jeremy. We are Australians. There is no colour. There is no race. It does not matter whether you were the first Indigenous or the first whatever or the latest person that's just come off the Qatar Airways plane today.
Perfectly true.
We are Australians.
Perfectly true.
You know
the Chinese. Yes. The Chinese could have a wonderful argument. They were the people who dug the gold out of the mines. They were the people who really produced the first wealth of Australia. They could come knocking on the door and say, we own this place. We built it. We dug all the gold out of the ground, and that's the gold that built the wealth of Australia. We want the country. We bought it.
Yeah.
But they don't do that because they just they're smart. They get on with their lives. They build on one success. They build on education. They build on intelligence, and they build on being clever.
Exactly.
Beyond belief.
And they don't stay victims forever.
Mm. Perfectly true, Maria.
Pull your socks up. You know, you've had the benefit of billions.
Yep.
And I agree that, the industry takes a lot of that money. But where are all these activists going up into the lands and helping the true full-blooded Aboriginal for a better life?
No, wouldn't do that.
No, you don't see the lawyers.
Yes.
You don't see Marcia. You don't see Pat. You don't see any of them going up and actually educating them into a better life.
No,
they talk a lot.
Yeah, and a lot of them are, I imagine, or I'm sort of led to believe, I don't know, of course, but a lot of them are members from the or children from the stolen generation. Now, stolen generation, where would they have been? They wouldn't have doctorates, and they wouldn't be professors, and they wouldn't have the wealth that they have today had they been left in the families from which they were rescued, I would think. I prefer rescue rather than stolen. And whether you're black or white, no child should be left in danger.
No, definitely not. What about the children that were stolen from England? What about the people that got sent over here as convicts just for stealing, well, not stealing, trying to survive a piece of bread, and they were sent over here from England, from their families? You know, there is, you know, they want truth, Jeremy. You know, there's bad on both sides. Yes, we actually came in and settled and discovered a country. Yes, there was harshness on both sides. But don't say it was all one way.
No,
there was harshness with the First Nations actually doing bad things to the settlers as well.
It's never all one way. No, it's never all one way. Now, thank you, my darling. You have a lovely weekend and call me again next Friday. I'd love to talk to you.
Okay, then, Jeremy. Say hi to Caroline for us.
I will. God bless you.
It's written in the moonlight and painted on the stars. We can't change ours. Don't give up on us, baby. We're still worth one more try. I know we put a last one by just for a rainy evening, but maybe stars are few. Don't give up on us, I know we can still come through. Don't give up on us, baby.
Don't you give up on us, baby.
Sun and your rain, I was losing you before.
You're listening to the Court of Public Opinion with Jeremy Cordo.
Anthony Toop has arrived. I don't know who sent me this. It says, don't mention my name.
I'm
not making it up. I'm not making it up.
Where does it say that?
It just says, don't mention. But why did you send me something? And what was it that you sent me that I'm not supposed to mention? Give me a ring and tell me what that's about. Please, quickly. Telephone number if you'd like to talk to either me or the world on the World Wide Web. You can call 0491 65 68 60, and Anthony Toop has arrived. How are you, dear boy?
Oh, hi, Jeremy. How are you going?
Yeah, good, good, good. You're nicely relaxed and retired. I never thought I'd ever see the day that you would give up.
I don't know whether giving up is the right word. I don't think that's the correct word, but it was an opportunity and I took it.
Yeah. What did you do?
Well, the kids came home when I got sick, and they've met husbands here, and now they're having families here. So how good's that? Silver lining, being sick.
Yeah.
But so I've had so many people say about, you know, how can you afford to retire, or how can you retire, you know? And I'm going, well, it's easy. Just get really crook, get really sick.
Well, you don't look sick. You look very well.
I'm doing okay. I was meant to die 12 years ago, so I'm okay.
Well, good God. But I was talking about your obsession with motorbikes.
Oh, well, I've still got a couple. Yeah.
Well, you know, 12 years ago you were thinking of dying through some medical thing, but, you know, getting on a motorbike, good God, that's tempting fate, isn't it?
Oh, it is, but we don't get on that often now. Not as often as we used to. We used to be on them all the time. Now we're electric bikes. They're just as dangerous. Have you been up just up the hill from where we are here at the moment, which is the top of Adelaide, you know, in the hills there, Glen Osmond and that, and they have mountain bike riding. And Google it if you want to have a look at some really crazy, crazy behaviour. Google electric bike. I'm not sure what I Googled, but what I saw, I was going, oh, my God, is that what they do on these things?
Well,
so this guy was racing downhill mountain bike riding on an electric bike, and he stopped because his handlebars hit the sides of both sides of the track.
And he goes over the handlebars, I would think, wouldn't
he? Well, he didn't, because he'd done it plenty of times before, so he had the seat right down. But I was fascinated to see how crazy these guys are. They make us look like kindergarten children.
Well, it's tempting fate. I know when you're young, I mean, very young, you're kind of bulletproof and you don't really think anything is going to kill you. But surely gravity, you know, you've got to understand gravity.
Well, I mean, I think when I was on my first trip to America, and I've done quite a few trips to America every second year, the only thing interrupted this one was COVID. Couldn't get in. Couldn't leave, couldn't get in. Oh, mate.
So if you
That's another story.
If you hadn't been a real estate mogul, you'd have been a travel agent mogul.
Well, we've been to America a lot, and the first trip I came off, and I bounced and I rolled, but I don't think I'd roll. I think I'd just break everything now. I think those days of rolling are done.
No, well, we don't bounce very well when we get to a certain age. The problem seems to be that people get either too active in the garden, or they want to change a light bulb and climb a ladder. You know, never climb a ladder.
Well, ladders are meant to be the major cause for admissions of elderly people or older people into hospitals.
It's because
they go up and they grab things and they reach out. Mate of mine fell off his he had a chainsaw, electric chainsaw, and fell off the roof of his place, his holiday house. And you'd all know him if I mention his name, but most people would know him, or a lot of people would know him, because he owns we did own a business, but his kids have taken over his business as well. But he fell off with the chainsaw in his hand, and he thought about was saving his chainsaw, not saving himself.
But if it's the only thing you can hang on to, I suppose you do.
Well, I guess
all the way down.
All the way down, and it was brand new, so it was an electric chainsaw.
Do you reckon in those years, because they were wonderful years when you were setting that business up and it was going from strength to strength. When I first came here in 76, the big agent, the big guys, it was a company called Woodham Biggs.
Woodham Biggs, Biggs. They were huge. And Gaitchens.
Yes.
Quite a few, actually. And B.W. Carey.
Yeah, yeah. Now, all of those sort of went by the wayside. I would suggest perhaps that your company had a bit to do with that, because you really took over and became the dominant premier real estate company.
We certainly made an impression, yeah.
You certainly did. Mm. Do you ever think in your mind how was that sort of, you know, kissed on the nose by a fairy, or did bloody hard work?
Just hard work and I think a real thirst for changing things, actually, mm-hmm. for the better.
What did you want to change?
Well, I remember, there were gimmick ads run against us by some of the Sturgeons, what do you call it, the historic old names, and they used to run ads against what we were doing and the gimmick ads in the paper.
But what were you doing that caused them so much angst?
It was non-stop. I remember
they didn't like the new kid on the block.
That's right. And around the corner here, we were selling our own home, and it was at the time that they were doing no dummy bids. So we said no dummy bids at this auction. And I thought, just woke up one morning and thought, well, we can't go carrying on about no dummy bids at Toop and Toop unless we have no dummy bids at our own auction. And that was before the legislation, and do you reckon I got in trouble with the industry for that?
Wow. Yeah, well, I went to an auction. I've always been fascinated by real estate. And
yes, I know you have.
I can't help myself. But I think it's the best investment that anybody can make. You know, the shares go up and the shares go down, and you've got boards of directors over whom you have really no say and no control. But if you have some dirt, they're not making it anymore. But if you've got some real estate, you can look at it. It's a bit like having an old...
Well, you can use it and you can live in it.
Yes, yeah. And you know, you do have capital gains tax and stuff like that. Old cars, another good investment, because there's no capital gains tax. And you can look at it and within the realms of decency drive it a few times a year. But it's something to show for your investment money.
Yes, well, and something to enjoy, I guess.
Yes, yes, yes.
And particularly, I think, during the COVID period, you know, where... everyone was reassessing everything, yeah. And, you know, this whole baby boomer retirement sort of stuff is, I think, in no small way to do with COVID. You know,
it's changed everything, hasn't it?
It's changed so much. And so now, you know, you go to a tradies, we're talking outside the room here before I came on, about trucks and, you know, and cars and repairs and not being able to even converse with the person that's fixing your truck.
Yeah.
Not being able to explain to them in English, you know, which is meant to be, I thought, our language, but it's not. Yeah. And just trying to explain to them that, no, that's not what I want. I want, you know, X, Y, Z.
Mm-hmm.
Not Y, Z.
Seems reasonable to me.
Well, you know, it's not the way it works anymore.
Why you've always called yourself Anthony Toop. Why didn't you go for something snappy like Tony Toop?
Because of two single syllables.
Okay.
And it does not work.
Okay. As a family business, it must have been a great joy to see it all come together and flourish and become so successful.
It was. We were the national, you probably don't even know this because we stopped bragging about it by then, but we were the national Hall of Famers in real estate, and we were bigger interstate than we were here, actually, you know, in terms of
I didn't know that,
brand no. and that. Yeah.
Didn't know that.
Yeah.
If you were running it right now and you mentioned COVID, and all the changes that has brought about, I saw some figures that indicate great vacancies in city buildings, office buildings.
Yes.
And speculation about how the landlords are going to have to do something, the investors are going to have to do something because there is not the return that they anticipated or counted on. So maybe we turn them into apartments.
Well... interesting you mention that, because that's just market forces. But unfortunately, the government have stuck their nose into everything, including the Liberals and the Labors. This is not, it's not, you know, politically driven conversation. And so I've had calls to go into politics lately, and I say, me and politics, no, we are water and You know, just we know.
But you could bring a new dimension to it. You don't have to fit in with the current.
Well, I think politically you do at the moment, but maybe not in the future. But yeah. Right now, I think that people. I was listening to the radio. You know, the mainstream radio that you.
The old-fashioned radio.
The old-fashioned radio. On the way down, and they're talking about charging now for internet connections.
Mm. Oh, they want to get control of the World Wide Web. They would love to get control of this.
They're in the process of trying to do that
now.
Yes,
they are. Yes,
and monetizing it. And then they had the discussion about the yes vote, you know, the amount of money that's being thrown around on that. And it's just fascinating.
And you've been a very successful businessman. Why would big business throw its weight and its money in behind the yes vote? Why would they get political with something as stupid as that?
Well, if you hear the podcasts, you know, which you may or may not get time to listen to while you're busy doing setting up your own gig here. But for example, the money—it's all about money. So, $250 million, I think it was quoted by Sam Newman on one of the stations, and was given to the AFL on the proviso that they would provide a stadium or assist the stadium down in Tassie.
Oh, sure.
And that's
you know,
a lot of money.
They're backing the yes vote. So,
well, that was the decision. Back the yes vote, and we'll give you $250 million towards your
stadium. Well, that's outrageous.
I know, but that's just what you're hearing everywhere, and $100,000 fine for, and the guy doesn't even know what for. So there's some really weird things happening, and I think the punters out there, the people listening to this at the moment, understand that it's getting more and more difficult to actually find this. You know,
well,
conversations.
Well, you've got to have a freedom of thought and freedom of speech and a means by which you can have your say and through the telephone or guests have a broad understanding of people's
views rather than filtered views and
well,
of one or two.
Political correctness that has seems to have invaded everything.
Yeah.
You know, people are frightened. They're frightened. It's almost as though, it's not that you're offending me. I am angry because I'm taking offence on somebody else's behalf. Totally bizarre.
You know, that whole thing with what you do with your children and under certain circumstances, I'm going, that's what I would do. You know, but see, you don't hear that, do you?
Well, I suppose you're not allowed to hear that, but, well, you will on the Court of Public Opinion for as long as they let me sit here and do it.
Until they do what they did this morning to you.
Well, I don't know that they did it. I think we've just, we had a good day last week and everything seemed to work just fine, so we were full of optimism, positive thought.
Two separate glitches.
Yeah, two separate glitches all on the one program. But, you know, I accept that. I can imagine back when radio first started 100 years ago, virtually today, commercial radio, I imagine they had many glitches.
Well, I had Toop's TV for 5-6 years. That was one of the innovations. And that was when I was on the board of Port Adelaide. And I said to the board members, I said, look, you're worried about filtering and that will be your own transmitter. You know, you can nowadays. You can do that.
Yes. Well, we are doing it. I remember some of my fondest memories are those very early Christmas parties that you used to have.
Oh, yes.
You know, where you were the one. You were the one who got there behind the barbecue and cooked the sausages.
People drinking beer out of bottles.
And your children.
Very basic.
You know, the girls were,
serving the drinks.
But 7 or 8 years old.
And then we had these guys rock up and they started to tell us we had to have licenses for this stuff. And I'm going, huh? How come you have to have a license to give someone a bottle of beer? That doesn't make sense to me.
Why don't they just pull their nose out of our lives and our business? And
just leave us alone.
Just leave us alone. There was a great, I can't remember his name. He was a liberal Democrat, I think he was. Now, what was his name? Caroline, do you remember his name? He lost his seat, so I suppose there's not a lot of value in his slogan. But his election slogan was, vote for me and we'll leave you alone.
Well, I've suggested to numerous parties, not just one, that if they were reward to outcome, so if they were rewarded, so for example, if for every new bit of legislation, if they had to get rid of two or three lots of legislation each department, so that would very quickly bring it under control. But it's not how it works. They just keep putting layer upon layer upon layer.
Yeah, and bureaucracy upon bureaucracy upon bureaucracy.
And that's costing. And what I can't stand, my personal grudge, is this. It's free. Nothing's free.
Somebody has to pay.
Somebody's paying. Somebody has to pay. Is paying for everything. Everything. There's not anything that's free.
But I think there are probably fewer and fewer people putting in. More and more people, the baby boomers, are going to retire. And they're going to be wanting to take it out, not put it in.
The problem's going to come when those two plates collide, and I think they're about to right at the moment. Well, they're in the process of colliding as we speak.
Yeah, I sometimes think to myself that I'm glad I'm the age that I am. I wouldn't like to be starting out in this world as a young man. I think I've seen, and you and most of us have seen the best of it.
Well, I don't know whether we've seen the best or not, but all I can say is that I got to a stage with the business and you said, why did you retire? I said, well, when you don't understand that you've made a mistake, then I need to retire.
What mistake did you make?
Well, my father, who's passed away 10 years ago or longer, he didn't start the business. Sylvia and I started this business, but he didn't even know that it wasn't okay to pinch girls on the bum, on the bottom.
Well, it's a compliment in some parts of the world.
It used to be, but it's not now. It's not. I can assure you, it's not now. And I get that, but some of the stuff that like gollywogs and stuff like that were made years ago. Mm. I don't get why they're suddenly taboo.
They're not. They're only taboo if you let them tell you and you accept that they're taboo. I just don't have a bar of it. It's like this
and
welcome.
Coon cheese. There's
coon
nothing
cheese.
To do
nothing
with,
wrong with coon
nothing
cheese.
Nothing to do with.
No.
Nothing.
Mr. Coon.
Absolutely nothing to do with whatever they're pretending it's to do with.
It's nothing. It's
and by capitulating, all they're doing is doing the popular vote thing.
But why do we capitulate? I mean, common sense and intelligence should trump this political correctness and cancel culture stuff. Surely.
Well, I don't know. Used to, but I don't know whether it does anymore. And fortunately, I just don't get involved. I'm just out.
No, well, I when you say out, when they do this welcome to country stuff,
I've spoken to Jetstar and said to them, I couldn't get anything more. Oh, I was at the Dish. This is not far away. The Dish. You know, the movie that called The Dish.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And that's at Parks, P-A-R-K-E-S, which is in New South Wales. It's just west of Sydney.
Yeah.
It's on the same sort of latitude. Anyway, I said to the girl there, why are you running three flags? She said, she looked at me completely bemused that I would ask why they're running three flags. So they got three flags up. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, I thought we were one country. And she just looked at me sideways. And I'm going, oh, okay. So I get it. And I got written to by the councillors who are trying to do the right thing, presumably, or hope they are, from a place we bought a beach house down in Fisherman's Bay. And it was they wanted to know our thoughts on, you know, what flag to put in the town. And I'm going, Port Broughton. This is South Australia. And I'm going, well, I thought there was only one flag. There's not one flag. And they suggested that maybe it should be one flag, but, you know, the thing is it wasn't. They were asking our thoughts of putting three flags up, and I'm going, why three flags? Mm. Three of the same flag.
Makes
maybe.
No sense.
And then this Welsh guy that used to work for me, now works for Bronte and Jen, he said, why Australians? He said he understood, he's a young guy, he understood why Australians are seen as racist. A racist country. He said because you're giving too much away to other people and you're not doing it to everyone. And I'm going, ah, that's a very simple explanation. Actually, when you think about that, you know, in depth, that's actually quite a in-depth, very simple analogy. And that is that they're giving money to one section of the community and it's not their money. It's
No. Because their ideology is devoted to a little grab bag of left-wing things like climate change and Aboriginal this and Aboriginal that.
Would be popular.
No, I think they're driving an agenda. They want to sort of channel people and our belief and confidence in certain directions, and they're using our money to do it.
That is definitely an issue. And one more comment that, you know, it's along the same lines is I spoke to a guy in Airlie Beach who was travelling around Australia. He's an Adelaide guy and a very influential guy. And I said to him, I'm voting no, you know, in the coming referendum. What are you voting? Yes. Why? And I asked him why. And he couldn't answer it. He said, oh, I don't know, but something's got to change.
But what you've got to change is the Aboriginal people need a forensic accountant. They don't need a voice because they've had plenty of voices. They're overrepresented in the Parliament of Australia. I mean, the population is 3% and the number of politicians, members, representatives, that is 11. So they have 5% of the Parliament. You know, 3% of the population has 5% of the parliament. Okay, so they're overrepresented. Now, if you want more people in power, you just get them to run for office and do it the way we all do it.
Well,
democratically.
At Sunshine Coast, I was speaking to a guy whose car looked like it had rusted out pretty much, and I said he's spending too much time on Fraser Island. Turned out he was actually one of the representatives for the Aboriginals, and I couldn't pick him being Aboriginal looking at him. You know, so that's how white he was. Anyway, he invited me to my great disbelief, to a forum, Aboriginal guy forum, on protesting the yes vote against the yes to a no vote.
Yeah, well, it's because, not even a United.
Because he said the money that is going to be spent with these few people on just, and they will vote whichever way they're told to vote because That is what they're there for, to just clear the way. He said it's carte blanche control for these few people. He said it's just no. You know, it's got to be no.
This is the full 26-page document from the Uluru message from the heart. Not the one pager that the Prime Minister's always talking about that he's pledged to implement in its entirety. The 26 pages, and it's headed up the Uluru Statement from the Heart. This is it, 26 pages. And it goes through, they've even set up diagrams as to how the Parliament will look. They demand to have a certain area of Parliament House set aside for them. That's apartheid, separate development, which is what apartheid means. Separate development and a separate chamber. This chamber that they're going to develop is above the members and or the House of Reps and the Senate. So it sits above that, has more control, more authority.
Well, it doesn't have to answer anyone except the paycheck.
No, well, look, it's set out here in glorious black and white. Literally, page after page.
I can see you've read it thoroughly because you've got marks everywhere.
I have got marks all over it, but I don't want to badger people. I just want to encourage people to get a copy of it and to look at it and read it and understand exactly with open eyes.
So how do they get a copy?
Well, you can just go to the Sky News website and download it from the Sky News website. It's there in all its disturbing detail.
Okay, all right. Well, we weren't meant to be talking about this, were we? But
anyway, well, why not?
But it's a big topic, and I don't know why people aren't talking about it more. And so I spoke to a young guy yesterday about, you know, and he just said, I don't want to be involved in politics. I'm going, oh.
It's not politics, dear boy. It's your country.
Yes. No, but he, That, I'm just saying that was his reaction to
but
it.
He should join the dots and realise that the country's worth fighting for.
Well, it is, but not to us, but not to them.
Oh God! No, okay.
So they haven't had any bloodshed or anything. It's all just been too easy.
Yes, I know.
And I said to Sylvia, I said, look, you know, money can make and ruin lives.
Oh God, it can. Yes. So I think the only money
we were so busy making it for the kids.
Yes, yes.
We forgot about you know.
The only money people should have is that which they work for. That, because that gives it perspective. It gives it value. You know what you have done for it.
I've got endless stories here, Jeremy, which I won't bore your listeners with. But another one is, it's nonstop. So we're in Europe, okay? So you might say fat cat in Europe. Well, okay, well, whatever. This was, you know, 11 years ago, just after 12 years ago I was sick, so it must have been 10 years ago, about 2 years after I'd sort of recovered. Anyway, we were away and this guy who doesn't speak English and doesn't read or write any English at all was employed by an employment guy for the vineyard. Anyway, he just jumped on the middle of the night. This tractor fell off and off it. He didn't speak to anyone, just fell off it. And hurt himself, didn't kill himself, but he hurt himself. And then it was Sylvia's fault. And we've got a vineyard manager. We don't even know what blocks are what and when they're harvesting or anything. We don't know anything, which we probably should.
But you're supposed to take responsibility.
But it's our responsibility. And
it's his responsibility.
What's more, listen, this is even gets better. So we got told we had to put work instructions. We said, well, the guy won't be able to read it. Then you have to have it in their language. I'm going, oh, okay. So we've got to have it in their language. And so we have to pay them in their, you know, their...
Currency?
No.
Not
in
that.
Fact, while you're at it, it's not 10 cents a plant to prune anymore. It's 10 cents or award whatever's the lower. Oh, the higher amount. And so, you know, it's just weird. The whole thing's really weird. And they wonder why we're not competitive. And they say we're in a wealthy country. At the moment, we're in a wealthy country. Mm. At the moment. But I'm not sure that's going to continue. You can't keep digging up Australia and exporting it and getting paid crazy money for some of these resources.
And we've been coasting in that manner for a long time.
Well, we have been, but the signs are that they're going to be sick of it. They're sick of paying.
The lucky country, it is possible to run out of luck. It's possible.
Well, if you keep digging it up and a few people making a ridiculous amount of money on that, that's where I think, you know... Personally, I think they should look at, you know, rather than just spending more and more taxpayers' money, there's less and less people paying tax. Mind you, they've moved people off by putting the salaries up. They're trying to, I don't even want to get started. I mean, you've started me on this. I shouldn't really be talking about this stuff.
I think you're...
But it sits underneath everything, all this red tape. So the vineyard manager, who's an academic guy, he's now sick and he's now travelling around Australia because he's sick, and his wife was the finance operator of one of the biggest wineries in the region, you know, just near us. And anyway, they're travelling around Australia in a cheap vehicle and they sold their own little vineyard, and that's been run by another crowd. And... anyway, cut a long story short, he just can't believe the amount of red tape that's got involved with the wine industry. He said, we're competing with New Zealand. He's a New Zealander. Competing with New Zealand, and we're paying the wet tax here, but they're not paying it. Like, and now I'm not sure that's right or not. I really don't care. But it's indicative of everyone you talk to who's got a story to tell.
Doesn't it boil down to the political system whereby... we have to start electing people who will take this crazy system on and change it, reform it, improve it.
That's fine, but when you get cameras, everyone's got a camera in their phone now, and you get photographs posted on social media. I think social media's got a lot to answer.
Oh, it's anti-social media sometimes. Not this.
No. Well, the reality is that this is the only way you can deal with it, I suppose, the only way you can get your message out, because you can't say this stuff on mainstream radio anymore.
Well, if the radio station, when I own my own radio stations, I had great confidence and respect for the opinions of the people I employed, and they were totally entitled to have any say on anything that they wanted to. And that should be written in blood on all broadcasting licenses, that you should. Management can't take over and say, "I'm sorry, I'm not. You're not expressing my opinion." No, you will express this opinion, or you're out the door. that's censorship.
Well, anyway,
shocking.
You're right. Yeah, I completely agree. Like, there's no, you don't have any fight with anyone in this room, by the looks of the nodding of their heads.
Well, look, common sense should rule everything, and the red tape, if that is strangling
everything,
everything in society,
when we were in business, right, they brought in these taxes that which we had to administer, so they didn't have to put anyone in to administer them, and then suddenly administering all of these different things and then get it wrong, and the fines are, you can't jump over the fines, you go, but how does that work? How is this revenue for you, provided we do the right thing? If we do the wrong thing, you're going to fine us anyway, like crazy fines, like ridiculous fines. And, for example, land tax. And now this is Liberal, right? And everyone say, oh, you guys are Liberal Labor basher. Well, here's one for the Liberals. They introduced land tax in our world, in real estate world. And to this day, they still don't know what land tax to charge anyone, because of the stupid formula they came up with. And so there's Lucas, if you're listening, Rob, usually at the end of the street, and he's gone on some stupid retirement package because he didn't care.
I know.
But that's...
But who gave them the right to charge? And I can understand rates and taxes simply because somebody's got to pick up the rubbish and there are things around the neighbourhood to do things. But for the government to say, well, you own a property, you have to pay land tax. Why do we have to pay land tax?
Because you've got to pay your way.
Well, no, we dig our heels in and say, sorry, that's not the system that we want.
Well, to finish that story, so last year we had our accountants, since they sent us a bill for a couple of grand. And they're good accountants, but they said, oh, God, we've got to go back and speak to the land tax department again, on exactly the same information, exactly the same. $4,000 to $14,000 for land tax on one of our properties that we had. So we sold it. There goes a rental. And the rental was under market at $500 a week.
That's what'll happen.
And that's what's happening. And so then the government step up and say, well, we've got to replace all this. It's just madness. It's just crazy.
I think it's time that the adults took over the classroom, or the animals zoo. Are running the zoo.
The animals are running the
but
zoo.
But can you imagine anyone coming up with a system called payroll tax?
Payroll tax to tax you for employing people.
Yes, isn't that wonderful?
What are they thinking?
What a wonderful logic. If somebody came down from Mars and you had to explain this to him,
you couldn't.
They would
shake their heads and go, "Oh, look for another planet, thank you." Yeah.
I was saying yesterday on the podcast and the Facebook page that Peter Melanaskis is after some. Well, I suppose a think tank. He's going to put a lot of clever people around the table. I hope he puts the right clever people around the table who will tell him what he needs to know, what he wants to hear, looking for ways to boost the state, you know, looking for good, bright ideas for South Australia. And I gave him one for free, which was be the first state in Australia to do away with payroll tax. Just do away with it, like Bjelke Petersen did away with death duties. And millions of people flowed into Queensland because there was an advantage. a good competitive advantage. Now, if we became the first state in Australia to do away with payroll tax, mind you, it wouldn't be for long because the others would have to follow. But we would have a huge advantage over the rest of them.
Well, you get known for being innovative if you do enough of it, but you've got to keep doing it.
Well, we've got to keep pushing them to do it.
Yeah, well, I mean, he's the right guy to probably talk to about this stuff because at the moment, well, my understanding at the moment, he's quite logical. You know?
Yeah. Not ideological, but logical. Logical. I like that. Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm not a Labor or Liberal basher at all, but certain things happen. And then when the Libs did this stupid thing with land tax, I'm going, what are you thinking? These very people that have given you money to help you along the way are the ones you're punishing. I don't get that at all.
No, it's not logical. It's not logical. But you think about a government that introduces, when you've got the template of what to do and what not to do. When I was first here, there were no poker machines.
And the template was
you could see in New South Wales what poker machines had done to society and, of course, the poorest people because the whole poker machine thing seems to be punishing the poorest people in the community, not the richest. The richest can maybe afford to gamble, I don't know. But here you had a living, breathing example of what not to do, and what did they do? They legalized them and licensed
revenue
them.
Stream.
And
so
revenue stream.
Yes. So the red tape maybe needs to be looked at. If it were me, I would just if I told you what I'd do, I'd have any new legislation comes in, that's fine. We'll look at it. But you've got to get rid of two or three different bits of previous legislation. So life gets simpler, not more complicated.
Yeah. We have to do something about unintended consequences.
I think a lot of it, the intentions are you have one person in 500 or 5,000 that plays up and they try to legislate that one person out and that actually creates red tape.
Yep.
And there's unexpected consequences.
Yeah, but there's money probably in coming up with these silly ideas. And
well,
Tony's just handed me this. Indigenous man tries to block police from travelling down a public road through Aboriginal land. It's a completely different country, you see.
Well,
the police have no authority.
No. And you need a permit to go into their towns.
Public road, though.
That's weird.
It's a public road, yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah, there's a beautiful mountain up north coast of New South Wales called Mount Warning. And I think it was actually the Liberal government handed the
title
to Mount Warning over to the local Aboriginals. The
first thing
the first thing they did,
monetize it.
Well, what they banned all white people, but even worse, for some I don't know spiritual reason, even black women were not allowed on the mountain. And it was a wonderful tourist, photographic, wildlife place, popular tourist place. And now what is it? Nothing.
Well, I've got plenty of stories about that, but anyway, we won't go into that. But I can tell you a very current one, Cape York. Now, that's only – we took three friends up and we said, if you don't go up very soon, you will not be able to go to the Cape. Cape York, that's the tip of Australia. In Queensland, and the Jardine River, they doubled the price to cross it because there's crocodiles up there. Well, no, that's not why they doubled it.
Will we have to pay the crocodiles?
No, but the crossing is about 30 metres, 20 metres, and it was over $200 for us to cross it. About 30 metres.
Where does the money go? Who's charging the money?
I think initially the money was going to go into the community, but none of us made it. It's all gone to the families.
No.
One or two families, I think, from what I gather. Yeah. But they've given Queensland the size of Tasmania to the Aboriginals recently.
Well, you know, 55% of the land mass of Australia is owned by, or the Aboriginals have legal title to, 55%.
Yeah.
Of mainland Australia.
Oh, look, I've been up to Cape Levique, which is above Broome, beautiful part of the world. Mm. And we stayed in a resort which has now been closed. It was owned. And the multiple millions of dollars that went into making it, you know, satisfy the requirements of the current, you know, expectations of sanity and sanitation and, you know, cafes and toilets and everything. Mm. And it's just been closed. And you can't go anywhere near it. And next to that is a town where you need a permit to go in it.
Permit to go into the town?
Into the town. But so you see, it says everywhere, no admission unless you get a permit.
And on what basis do you apply for the permit?
Well, just you want to have a look. It's next door to Cape Levesque.
And on what basis would they refuse a permit?
I wouldn't have a clue, probably not. But I don't know. We didn't get a permit. We just tried to turn around and I left.
No, I don't
and
blame
we had a women's in business function we went to here in Adelaide just recently. And the whole night we heard the politicians speaking about the yes vote. And I'm going, we didn't come for this.
No.
We came, you know, for the – it was a charity event and we came for a different reason. We went because they thought they were genuine about
that
charity.
What council was this?
No, this was in the city.
Oh, right. Mitcham Council, apparently, I've been told.
40,000.
Yeah.
400,000.
Yeah.
400, sorry. It's 40,000, I think, of ratepayers' money, yeah.
40,000, but they'd already given 10,000, so it's 50,000 in total. $50,000 to the yes vote.
I thought. I wonder if they were trying to provoke everyone because I think that's all they did. They just stoked everyone up.
Yeah.
It's just unbelievable. People are now whinging about, you know, their roads and the paths and
yeah.
And saying, well, if you've got that much money to throw around, throw some my way our way, and let's fix this bit of the path.
This is the part of this whole yes no thing that is divisive.
Oh, it's nothing more. It's divisive than when you land anywhere in Australia and you hear the welcome to country.
No.
And someone on radio this morning on the way down from the farm, we're talking about why do I have to put up with that? What's all that about? Why am I welcoming to my own country every time I fly in a frigging plane?
Yes, yes.
So I said to the hostess a while ago when I took one of the flights, I said, this is very divisive. This is just and she's
and irrelevant.
It's got nothing to do with anyone, but, you know, maybe the politicians, I don't know. But it's certainly got nothing to do with us. And I don't know why they're politicising air traffic unless they were given money. And it's not given their money, it's given our money to them.
But maybe they get concessions or something from the government and the government says, well, you'll do this or...
Well, based on Sam Newman's conversation...
Yeah. Or we'll come around and check all the engines and guess what, we're going to find trouble.
We're going to find problems.
Problems, yes.
Yeah. Well,
then we need public companies to stand up and say that they are being blackmailed or they're being...
But that's not the way to get the money. The way to get the money is just nod their head and say, yeah, we'll do that.
Well, it's the way to lose the country.
Well, the country is disappearing right before our very eyes, so...
Well, we've got to dig our heels in and stop it.
Well, I don't know.
Listen to this, Anthony, listen to this. An Aboriginal man has tried to stop a pair of police officers from entering Indigenous land by using his car to block off the public road. Bruce Magadatta Shillingsworth, a proud Murawari man... confronted the officers in the outback New South Wales town in a video posted on social media this week. We've got the police here. What's happening? They're going out of their way to enter our land. Our land? It's our country.
No, that it was... I mean, we've been the top of Ayers Rock. I've settled. Oh, it's not Ayers Rock, Eulari's Rock.
Mm.
And I thought that was part of Australia too, but it's not. You can't climb the top of that anymore.
Well, I'm sorry. We've got to stop this nonsense because it's not going to benefit because the vast majority of people who are putting money into the coffers of this government, if we stop doing that. If we see no good reason to do it anymore...
They'll run out of money.
But the Aboriginals won't get their $35 billion a year plus land rights.
I don't think that the Aboriginals as a collective group are interested in what's going on at the moment at all.
No, so the activists, and surely they're not numerous enough to be a problem against the entire common sense population of the country.
I think this apathy of the young that haven't had any trials or tribulations, haven't had any real skin in the game, is what they're relying on. And that's all the, you know, 18, the voting age, 18 to 25 probably.
I wish I could find it. A lady sent me a thing about this Welcome to Country business where she went through all of the...
it's on every single building. So I took photos of it down in Western Australia. And it was on the tourism. It was on their Welcome to Country on their tourism doors.
Yeah.
You know, like it was just everywhere. Everywhere you went was Welcome to Country. I'm going, hang on a minute. So I'm a visitor in this country. Is that what you're really trying to say?
That's what they're trying to say.
Well, that's what they are saying, actually. That's not what they're trying to say. And I'm going, but I'm not a visitor. I was born and bred here, paid a huge amount of tax, which is, you know, and one of the reasons we've got properties in Queensland is the amount of money going in up there is unbelievable. It's just incredible. Just roadworks. You go up the Bruce Highway, and which goes all the way up to the top. And honestly, it is a nightmare because of roadworks. And it's not little roadworks, it's huge roadworks. And I'm going, where's all this money coming from? Because I know how much it costs to put a road in, and it's very expensive because we've got 2 kilometres of bitumen, very narrow, one strip up to the... And we had to negotiate very hard a long time ago for that, to get that at that price. So these are millions, multiple millions of dollars. And so where's all this money coming from?
Well...
Where's all this money coming from?
I'd like to know where it's going.
Well, you can see where it's going. You know, we you just need to travel a bit. And years ago, in 94, we went around Australia with the kids. And even then, the burnt out cars everywhere. And if you speak to the car guys, in fact, you should really speak to my neighbour who's got stations. His family have stations. And he's saying the secret women's business, secret men's business that everyone goes on about is really secret because of what they do at them.
Yeah. Look, I'm prepared to believe that. There was a story around this morning about a busload of kids, Alice Springs, a busload of kids all under the age of 12. They literally hijacked the bus, 2 o'clock in the morning, stole the bus, and they were driving around Alice Springs, yelling and screaming, and eventually the police had to spike the tyres.
To stop the bus.
Stop the bus, get in the bus, arrest the kids.
Which would have got thrown out of court immediately.
Oh,
which
sure,
reminds me of a broom story. Do you want a broom story?
Yeah, give me the broom story.
Okay, so we're in this little hotel, just cheaper than... We Broome has got a couple of really lovely... did have tourists... nice tourist spots.
Beautiful spot.
Anyway, this ex-Adelaide one, not far from the main game up there, not far, you know, walking distance, was telling us, lock your doors. And so why would we lock it? Make sure you lock your doors and take your key with you because they've got these young Aboriginal kids that done over 200 robberies. Because they're so young and the police just waiting for them to turn 18 before they can touch them.
Yeah.
And I go, but that's wrong.
Of course it's wrong. Because they'll
it's teaching them really bad things.
As the twig is bent, so shall grow the tree.
Mm.
By the time they're 18, they will be
hardened criminals.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
They won't turn 18 before they stop doing this, but...
No.
Well, I don't know, actually.
I had a listener who used to ring me from Tennant Creek and the stories he would tell me were just amazing.
I don't think for a second there hasn't been the wrong thing done by these guys. Our forefathers perhaps, or their forefathers probably that far back.
Mm-hmm.
But they're trying to open that can up now and pointing the finger in the bone, if you like, at us. And I'm going, but hang on, we're bystanders in all this.
Didn't do it.
But you don't hear any of that, none.
No, there's no balance and there's no logic being applied to it. It's just sort of a group think.
Yeah, and this guy that's very influential in Adelaide telling me that I don't know why I'm voting yes, but I'm going to vote yes. And I'm going, but aren't you a thinker? No, well, I can't get any details, so but something's got to change.
Yeah,
I'm going,
when in doubt, don't.
When in doubt, especially with the Constitution.
Don't.
And so the local Labor Party here was telling me at the Variety Show that they don't understand either. And so they've put it through on legislation. If it doesn't work out, they can change it, which is a lot more smarter than constitutional changes, which you can't change.
But I think they pulled the local legislated yes voice thing. I think they pulled that because what did Peter Malinowski say? He said it is going to confuse the referendum. Now, I don't think... Yes, it is going to confuse because you've got far too many people thinking they're either going to be involved in the voice or angry because they're not involved in the voice. You've got 400 separate clans and tribes in Australia, and you're not going to be able to satisfy all of them with equality. Clearly, there are going to be some people, powerhouse or prime movers in all of this, who are going to be overrepresented. The little guy and the little woman, they're not going to be represented. Let me read you this from Lynette, a new version of the Welcome to Country that I would like to have implemented. It says, I would like to pay my respects to elders past and present, to the Italian elders who built our roads, railways and telecommunications and infrastructure, to the Greeks and the Turkish elders who are giving us tasty Eros and kebab shops, to the Jewish elders who gave us all the Westfield shopping centres and Meriton apartments.
And so on.
And to the Chinese elders who gave us all the $2 shops, and to the Irish elders who gave us all a great Irish or great Irish pubs and Irish whiskey, and to all the Asian elders who have given us nasi goreng, dim sims, sweet and sour pork, short soup. I'm getting carried away. I put some of that in there. Let's celebrate their accomplishment and contributions to the country. And I think, Lynette, I told you I'd read it out. I think that's very clever and very right.
Yeah, well... My wife is Swiss Polish, and she said, "So when do the Swiss and the Polish get an opportunity to have a voice?"
Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
So you know, it's just flaunt with just it's just it can't happen.
Yeah,
and which is why I guess I'm on today, really, Jeremy, is that some of the stories and some of the things you see with your own eyes and just you just go, "What are they thinking?" What are they thinking?
The trouble is they're not thinking.
No, they're just very short-sighted. It's about what happens in 4 years' time when the election comes up. You know, will the unemployment be down? Will the rates be down? Will people be in less pain? Yeah. Will they vote for me? That's it.
Well, again, you've got the short-term thinking because everything is from 1 year to the next in terms of the budget, 1 year. And if it's not that, it's the political cycle. It's either 3 years or it's 4 years. And they're not going to think out nation building or forward over the horizon stuff because they're not going to be there to benefit from it or even to be penalised for it. So it's just short term, whole thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's why China's, you know, and what's going on in Russia and Ukraine at the moment is so dangerous is that, you know, unfortunately, whether you like it or not, they do get things done.
They do, and because you can't really tie yourself down with this endless debate and you know, like the Kimber thing with the repository for the nuclear waste. I mean, by the time you talk to everyone and get everyone's opinion, you're never going to satisfy everybody. And obviously the Chinese Communist Party have a more... Well, what can I call it? Direct approach.
Well, I don't agree with handing it over, but, you know, when things like it's going on at the moment happen, you go, oh, God, just save me, please.
There's endless waste of time and just debate and all the rest of
time and money and
you'd make a good politician.
Oh, no, would I
make a good politician.
Terrible politician. I think the politicians that are in power need to not be looking forward to, you know, more power. I think they should be already, you know, just well set up, and, you know, they're doing it because they believe in it, not because they want the recognition or the table one at everything and, you know, everything for nothing. And you only have to look locally and, oh, God, some of the rorts and that go on, it's just terrible. Just terrible.
Don't we have a sort of an ICAC that's supposed to look after things like corruption?
That's just another body of people all on big payrolls to make sure that everyone that's paying them is happy.
Yeah. What I loved about that story, you familiar with the Gladys Berejiklian story in New South Wales?
No.
Well, she was the Premier, a very good Premier. And
I knew that.
She had a romance with this guy, the member for Wagga, I think it was, Maguire. Anyway, I won't go into a character analysis of the bloke, but anyway, they attacked her because of certain things that they thought the Premier had been in favour of in that electorate because of her relationship. You know, and I think even within your own party, you've got people who want to bring you down. There's jealousy everywhere. Anyway, they did bring her down. They had the ICAC investigate her. 2 years, this is after they ruined this woman's life, 2 years after they came up with the conclusion that she had committed serious, what was it called? Oh, I don't know, serious corrupt behaviour, I think it was. Serious corrupt behaviour. And they had the opportunity to refer the whole thing off to the DPP. And when asked why they weren't going to send off this awful charge about this nice lady, maybe a naive lady when it came to matters of the heart, but anyway, oh, no, we can't put this to the Director of Public Prosecutions because we don't have enough evidence. You know, we don't have enough we've got enough evidence to ruin her life, but we've got no evidence to charge her with anything. That's
well,
okay.
I really should get off this microphone,
Johnny,
because...
Well, Johnny Cash is going to sing us out.
I think this is slasherist stuff. No.
Well, anyway.
But the only thing you can do is look forward and go, well, you know, looking forward, is it yes or no? That's probably a big
one. Well, I think it's the major thing that's confronting
us.
And then
how much money has gone into... I think there should be an inquiry into how much money...
Yes.
Just been wasted.
And then where did the money go?
And who paid?
Yeah.
And the biggest payers.
Follow the money. Always follow the money.
Yeah.
Anyway, a good time.
Nice to see you.
No, it's wonderful to see you. God bless you and good luck with everything
you do. Thanks, Jeremy. Thank you.
It's really nice to have you. Have you on the show? Now, I'm going to find Johnny Cash because somebody said you should finish the show with the song that you finished the show with. When I was at AA, because it says it all from my point of view anyway, from me to you. Thank you very much for being with us. We'll be on Facebook next week with the Court of Public Opinion from the Garage, and that'll also be on podcast. Thank you for listening. Believe in yourself, and bye for now.
When you're all alone and blue, no one to tell your troubles to, remember me. I'm the one who loves you. When this whole world turns you down, not a true friend can be found. Remember me, I'm the one who loves you. And through all kinds of weather, you'll find I'll never change. Through the sunshine and the shadow, I'll always be the same. We're together, right or wrong. Where you go, I'll tag along. Remember me, I'm the one who loves you. Through kinds of weather, you'll find I'll never change. Through the sunshine and the shadows, I'll always be the same. We're together, right or wrong. Where you go, I'll tag along. Remember me, I'm the one who loves you.